September 17, 2016, Board of Supervisors meeting. Please stand for the pledge. Ms. Frescatore, will you lead us in the pledge?
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands,
one nation,
under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And please remain standing for a moment of silence for those serving our country, both at home and abroad. Thank you. Go right into announcements. Ms. Frescatore.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, fellow board members, residents. I have announcements from the Parks and Rec services in our township. We have discount tickets available Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. For more information and prices, check the website. We accept cash and credit cards as payments. Discount premier movie tickets, Regal, Edwards, United Artists Theaters are sold for $9.50, quite a bargain. P&R will sell limited amusement park and local attraction tickets through the fall. Check online for a price list or call the Parks and Rec Department for availability, as some summer attractions have closed and are on weekend schedules only. As per Bucks County regulations, Parks and Rec has stopped selling 2016 dog licenses and will begin with 2017 licenses in mid-December. We will begin taking applications, 2017 applications, for the Bark Park on December 1st. Only a few seats are left for the annual trip to Radio City Christmas Spectacular on November 19th. Register online or call Park and Rec office. Basket bingo tickets will go on sale December 1st for the event on February 24th, 2017. That's it, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Frescatore. Mr. Monroe.
Thanks, thank you, Mr. Chair. The only announcement that I have is just with respect to Thanksgiving, Thursday, November 24th. Obviously, there's no pickup for trash that day, so your next pickup will occur on your next regularly scheduled pickup day, and all other pickup days will occur normally.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Monroe. Mr. McPhillips.
No announcements tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Crowley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just want to announce the new businesses to town here in the last month or so. We'd like to welcome Classic Chiropractic over at 77 York Road. That's in the Altamonte's Beach Street Plaza. Spirit Halloween opened up at 848 West Street Road at Center Point Place. Just the other day, we had the ribbon cutting for the Police and Fire Federal Credit Union new building right over here at 505 West Street Road. And also, not too far away, the AAA Car Care is open at 602 York Road. We also have Horizon Dental Lab at 152 York Road and Boot and Shoot over at 210 West Street Road, which is the Centennial Plaza. As always, we thank these businesses for choosing to call Warminster home and wish them the best here. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Crowley. I have a few brief announcements, starting with we had an executive session to discuss personnel after the 13th of November or the 3rd of November budget workshop, which we had a budget workshop here to go over the budget in detail. It was open to the public. It wasn't a business meeting, but I thought it was a terrific night. The public, department heads, everyone had a lot of input, and look forward to doing that again in the future. It was really, really productive. Also, I wanted to announce that last Friday night we had our annual charity ball for the Warminster Rotary Club. It was a terrific evening. We had 250 people there. We raised money for a local family that really needs it. I want to thank Gilmore and Associates and Eastburn and Gray and Boucher and James and County Builders who bought sponsorships to this event. It was truly a great night. We really enjoyed it. My last announcement is I normally don't wear the facial hair, but it's Movember. It's Men's Health Awareness Month. I know I pound on this as often as I can, but being a cancer survivor, I like to use the pulpit to do so. All you guys out there, please schedule your colonoscopies. Don't wait till Christmas. Do it before and go get it after Christmas. It could save your life.
So Mr. Chair, may I add one more announcement?
Sure.
I forgot.
Go right ahead. Sure.
I just wanted to thank the Ben Wilson Senior Center. They had their annual fashion show at Anne's Choice. It was a great success. They raised a lot of money. They do a lot in this community for our seniors. And Chico, the clothes were really nice. They had a lot of residents from all different age groups fashioning the clothes, and it was a very nice event. So thank you to them and to Anne's Choice for allowing them to have it there. That's it, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. And I'm finished with the announcements, so we're going to move forward. There are no presentations tonight, and there are no public hearings. So I'm going to go right to public comment. Township residents have the opportunity at this time to comment on any non-agenda items subject to the five-minute guideline as recognized by the chair. Are there any public comment? Yes, ma'am. Please come up and give us your name and address.
Good evening. My name's Jerry Sedru. I'm at 462 Gibson Avenue here in Warminster. And I just wanted to give, I know that everyone gave some announcements. I have some things that I wanted to talk about for the library upcoming events. They're going to have their Thanksgiving fun with food festivities for children in grades K through 3, and that's going to be on Wednesday, the day before Thanksgiving. Going to learn about the first Thanksgiving through books and games, and also have an opportunity for the kids to make some food, churn their own butter, things like that. So if anyone wants to attend that program on Wednesday from 2 to 3, it's in the large meeting room. I request that you register online at the library's website or give the library a call. Also, a part 3 of the device advice series is going to be held on Thursday, December 1st from 10:30 to 11:30 in the large meeting room. It's an event where people who have electronic devices that need some assistance can come and get some help. This one is going to focus mostly on tablets with a 20-minute informational overview followed by questions and answers. So if anyone's having some problems, feel free to come with your devices, or if you just want to learn about them and think about getting one, putting it on your Christmas wish list, here's find out how to work it. And also, children in grades 1 through 5 are encouraged to join us on Saturday, December the 3rd. Chess club, high school students from the area, the local chess club members are going to be out at the library between 2 and 3 o'clock to teach the kids in grades 1 through 5 how to play chess, or since it's only from 2 to 3, it might be give them a general appreciation of the game. So that also will be at the library on December 3rd, 2 to 3, if you could register online or give the library a call. Also, the Friends of the Warminster Library is planning a speakers event for a series for next year. Saturday, January 28th, Eleanor Roosevelt, they're going to have someone come in and portray Eleanor Roosevelt. We'll have some selections of some of Eleanor's favorite snacks. There'll be light refreshments there. But we did this last year with Julia Child, so it was such a success, and the community had asked us to expand upon it. So January 28th is Eleanor Roosevelt. Harriet Tubman is going to be March the 4th, and Martha Washington, we're going to have an actress come in and play Martha Washington on April the 1st. So we're going to have it's $10 a ticket, and there'll be a series if you buy a ticket to all three events. It's 3 for $25.
That's are they I posted have. Online?
If they are not online, this would be on the Friends of the Library's website. They will be shortly, because ticket sales are going to start next month, a couple
Greg,
of weeks.
Greg, can we put it on our township website?
Absolutely. If you forward the details over to me, I'd be happy to get them up on the website.
Oh, great. Right. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much for that
You're
suggestion.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jerry.
Thank you.
Is there any other public comment? Yes, please come up.
I'm LM. I think she's got my information.
How you doing, LM?
Okay. I haven't been here for 4 months.
I know. We missed you terribly.
Okay, well, we're here because we need some information. First of all, I'd like to say we did have a meeting with Greg. It was I thought the best one that we've ever had in the last 5 years that we've had meetings about this stuff. But some questions are coming up. One is, today I know you talked to one of the other neighbors.
I left a message for one of them.
Yeah, I did. And she asked me, she's unable to make it here tonight for reasons that I know somebody knows, or I'll tell you if you really want privately. Mm-hmm. Anyway, what we got out of it was that you turned it over to Wawa, or they got a list. Am I correct with that?
Yes. So out of that meeting, we generated a list. The list was given to you.
Right. I have it here.
And we turned that over to Wawa through Mr. Savona.
Oh, okay. Now, did he make changes on that?
I made no changes, Ellen. The list that Mr. Schuster gave me was forwarded to Mr. Hecker. He's reviewing it. I spoke to him actually today.
Okay. Now, when did it get forwarded to Mr. Hecker, though?
It's been probably within days of when Mr. Schuster gave it to me. They've had it for quite some time.
Right. Now, you contacted him today. Now, what did he have to say?
He contacted me today.
Okay.
Wawa is has reviewed it. They've taken several weeks to review it. They are going to, they have put together a response that was being cleared with their general counsel's office, and then Mr. Hecker was going to send it back to us. So he said his goal was to try to have it back, hopefully before Thanksgiving, but it would really depend on the timing of when Wawa approved it internally.
Okay, okay, that's what we were just wondering, because I know at the last meeting when we were here, we had, they were willing to meet with us in person in Saba, but you didn't want that, and I don't know why you called them the next day, and maybe you could...
I didn't call them. I indicated to Mr. Hecker...
Maybe you could tell me why you said I attacked them.
I didn't tell them that you attacked them.
All right, then maybe you would like to clear this with Mr. Hecker then, because emails are funny. I got an email that wasn't supposed to be, got me attached and sent to me, but I know they don't know I have it. Until now. Everybody will know.
They know.
Emails.
Yeah, you told them.
I didn't tell them, but they know.
Well, they didn't know I had it, because it's not, I'm not even on the thing at all. My name is not on it to be even sent to. But anyway, it says, Lori, I just spoke to the township attorney, which is you, and I agree with his direction that you shouldn't have any more direct dealings with Mrs. Mobley or the neighbors. Apparently, she went to the meeting last night and attacked all of us. I really am upset with that, because I reviewed
that.
The tape, and I did not attack.
No, and I wouldn't have said that.
Well, that's what they're saying, so maybe you better talk with Mr. Hecker and get this solved.
Well, that's precisely why we've been trying to streamline the communication. Mr. Schuster
wanted... Well, we were doing fine until then.
Except that we weren't getting it resolved.
Oh, yeah, we were getting resolved, but when the township, this has been 4 months ago, so this is how long, but if we had a meeting, we would have had it resolved right then and there at the meeting, and we'd have it done by now.
Okay.
Instead of still saying that they're looking it over, because when we met face-to-face with them the last time, we came out of there very much forward. And then it just goes on how you told them not to deal with us and to go directly to this. And you called the day after the meeting. So what you said at review the tape, because I just did before I came here. Mm-hmm. What you said at this meeting, you went the next day and called and told them, according to the emails.
I wasn't at a meeting. I sit in these meetings. I wasn't a party. You know that. I wasn't party to the meetings you had with Wawa.
No, no.
Nor was I a party to your meeting with Mr.
The Board
Schuster.
Of Supervisors meeting on October the 21st. Review that tape, because this email is sent on the 22nd.
We could haggle over emails.
No, I know, but I'm just stating. He says he wasn't there. He was here at the Board of Supervisors meeting.
No, I was certainly here at that meeting.
Yeah,
but
and
Mr. Hecker, frankly, has had that list since well before October 21st. That was only a couple of weeks ago.
Well, when are we going to make contact with them? Because Wawa doesn't do things fast.
They have had the list since whenever you met with Mr. Schuster.
On the 4th of October.
Okay. They got the list probably within days. They have been reviewing it. I've spoken to Mr. Hecker twice this week. Once was on Monday.
Do they have any comments about changes?
They're waiting for Wawa's general counsel to sign off on before they send it to us. They are going to have a response. But he hasn't shared with me what the response is until their corporate attorneys have signed off on it. That's what I'm waiting to get back.
And about how you think that should be done before another week or two?
I'm not going to guarantee it, but I'm telling you, today he told me he was hoping to have it to me before Thanksgiving.
Okay. But I just really need an explanation from you personally at one point why this was said about us, because I don't think it was fair.
I mean, I just have to defend Mr. Savona for a second. You have an email there about what someone is saying he said.
I didn't say it.
Except he said it the night before here at the meeting. And that's what is interesting, is he said they will not deal with you anymore because they were going to have a meeting with us, and he said they would not do it. And the next day, the email within their work is that he just got off the phone
with
you.
You met with Mr. Schuster. You put all of your concerns in writing. He submitted them to Wawa. Now, why would they deal with
well, no,
I don't want to be rude,
before,
but why would they deal
with
you?
This is before that occurred. That was before that was
requested. But I don't want to regress and regress.
His remarks, though. Okay,
when he I will certainly let him know that.
Because you said that I attacked them, so I do want an explanation.
No, you're attributing words to me that Mr. Hecker said.
I'm not going to continue. Okay, there's one other thing on behalf of a couple people. We just have to ask. The bank opened the very very nice building. Everything, no questions about it. Two things. One is there's a three-way stop sign there. Half the people don't even stop at it. So just so you know that. And if you do stop, you're going to get rear-ended sometimes because the person behind you isn't stopping for it. Mm. But that's fuel for thought. But there's on the back of the building, there's 9 lights.
Okay.
Our neighborhood we see 8 of them. very clearly. We might see the ninth because a couple of them turn. Can they ever be dimmed some? There's no buildings, there's no walls, there's no windows, doors, anything in the back, so nobody's going to break through. I don't mean off, but just...
I'm going to pass that down to Mr. Connor.
We can look at the shields. There probably are house shields on them, but we can look at that.
Yeah, they're just... I don't care what the...
We can't dim them, but we can do the shields.
Okay, but the ones in the back are just... They light up all... The overflow, the spillage into the neighborhood is bad. And also, the tall lights that they have, they're 5 feet higher, because we asked one of the workmen, than what Wawa and CVS. And could they just please put shields on them? That's all. We're not asking.
Mr. Connor, will you look into that?
Yeah, I called him, but he didn't return the call, but that was what it was about. Okay?
All right, thank you, LM. It's good to see you. Happy Thanksgiving.
I know, I can't believe it's here.
Can we?
Okay, is there any other public comment? Please come up. Give us your name and address, please.
Nancy Kenzer, 921 Georges Lane. Good evening, everybody.
Hello, Nancy.
Good evening.
The reason why we're here, I have several residents. I know you're not aware of this yet, but the property on 900 York Road was bought by a contractor who wants to change the zoning code to... change the zoning code. Right now it's single residency, and he wants to put 14 twin townhomes, and the lot is only 4.2 acres. I'm sorry, not 14, 4.2. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I'm nervous.
Take your time, relax.
It's okay. I have tons of people who signed a position. They're not interested in this. When the gentleman bought the lot, he originally sent everybody a notice stating that he was going to three single-family homes. Now he's claiming hardship that the way the lot is set up, that he cannot do that, and this is why he wants to change it. We're here just to express our feelings and let you guys know that we really want to keep it single-family. It's a single-family area. And that's what we want. We don't want these 14 twin townhomes in the back of our yards.
Mm-hmm. Is that on the docket for the zoning board?
Yes, it is on the 29th.
And therefore, the board cannot comment.
I understand.
On it.
But
however, Mr. Schuster is free to comment on it.
Yeah, well, just obviously I won't comment on the heart of the matter, but I will say on the 29th is the zoning hearing board. I would encourage you and any other resident that's concerned about this to go ahead and attend that. It's very important that you attend because that's where an official record is built, so you can go ahead and testify. You could even seek party status if you're so inclined. After the zoning hearing board, if the zoning hearing board does give relief, it could come before this body, in which case you'd have another opportunity to speak. But right now, I would advise the board not to say anything because it's not before them, and it'd be improper for them to go ahead and say something.
Okay.
Well, you bring your neighbors and bring your petitions absolutely to the zoning board meeting.
Okay. Thank you.
Well,
we hear you, and we appreciate your concern.
Okay.
No.
29th, not all of these people will
Wait a minute, sir. You have to come to the podium if you want to be recognized.
Just to reiterate what Mr. Schuster said, is claim party status.
Right.
That's what's important.
And as many as you want to do that.
And your name, please.
Okay. Yeah, William Cooper. All of the people that we were hoping to go to that meeting on the 29th, a great portion of them won't be able to, which is ironic in its own way because they'll be hunting. Okay? Now, maybe that's why the first meeting was postponed. This I don't know.
Well, we don't get involved. The zoning right, hearing board is a separate entity
rate,
from this
a
board.
A lot of them won't
separate.
Be able to attend that meeting. Now, when we go to that, can we postpone it?
No.
Do you know?
Now, that's under the control of the zoning hearing board. So one of the things that you could do is all the interested residents, you could send a letter to the zoning hearing board through their chairman or through their solicitor and perhaps ask that they continue the hearing to another day so that you can maybe go to another day and give some more testimony. But that is really under the purview of the zoning hearing board.
And Greg, they could send copies of the petitions to them too, stating that they'd rather wait to a better time. Is that correct?
They could. Are they admissible if they're sent like that? They could be part of the record.
Honestly, the best bet for you guys is if you're going to go to the meeting, you don't all have to be there at the first meeting. But if one or two of you manage to make it, and you are recognized as a party. Once you're a party, then you could ask the board to continue it.
Okay.
So that you'd have another opportunity to bring any other information to the board that you think's relevant. It doesn't have to end on the 29th, in other words.
All right. That's fair enough. I appreciate that. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for coming.
You're welcome.
I hope we answered your questions.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Have a nice holiday.
You too.
Thank you, too.
Happy Thanksgiving. Is there any other public comment?
Run.
Okay. Seeing none, I'm going to move on to the consent agenda. Mr. Schuster.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A number of items on tonight's consent agenda. Items A and B are your minutes for the October 20th meeting and the November 3rd budget workshop meeting. Item C is the resolution authorizing the allocation of the foreign fire insurance taxes as a pass-through that comes to us, and then we pass it through to the volunteer fire companies. Item D and item E is the approval of compensation for the tax collector. Any changes to the tax collector's compensation must be done in a specified time period before the election occurs and would take effect after the election and with the new tax collector's term begins. The item F is from the last meeting when you had a discussion from a resident about the violent sex offender registry. This resolution states your belief that there should be notification of any offenders working near residents, not just living, but working, mm-hmm. so they would get that notification. That information is in a database, right. But the notification does not occur. Item G would extend the duty tow contracts throughout 2017. We're still re-examining that ordinance and alternatives, and so we'd like some time to go ahead and do that, so we're fine extending that along with the current participants through the end of 2017. Item H is a waiver of land development for the Hartsville Fire Company. They are putting up a pole barn. As you can see by the documentation, has been reviewed by staff, and staff and the engineer is okay with the waiver of land development. Item I is a escrow release for the Hart School redevelopment as recommended by the engineer. Item J is a audit, business privilege tax audit by eCollect. They will go ahead and audit our business privilege tax, and this will be at no cost to us. They will keep, per the contract, 20% of the fee of everything they find, and we will keep the remainder. We are doing this in conjunction with the school district. They are entering into the same agreement. Item K is authorization to advertise the ordinance for the codification. We have received the draft codification back from General Code. We are still reviewing it. There's a process that we have to go through, and it's not ready for you to take any action, but we want to get the authorization to advertise as we continue through the process. Item L, what was going to be the snow removal bid, I'm asking you to remove that from consideration. We received only one bid, and the bid was not complete, so we are going to go out and rebid. And item M was just completed today. That's the natural gas contract. Copies were put in front of you. And our current rate is 63.7 cents. And the new rate for 24 months, based on the reverse auction that we did, would be 49.9 cents. So a significant reduction in our costs. Okay. And that is the consent agenda for this evening.
Is there a motion to adopt the consent agenda?
Motion.
Mr. Monroe, is there a second?
Second.
Second. Mr. McPhelps, is there any discussion from the board on the consent agenda?
Yeah, just on, I know we're removing item I, snow removal. One bid, are we able to say who that one bid was from? Or?
Do you have any problem saying that?
No.
It was from Costa, I believe his name was.
Costa?
Yeah, okay. It was a previous contractor
right,
that we were
right,
working
that's
with.
What
yes.
I saw
so Bloom and Glenn didn't.
They did not bid, no.
Okay.
And we're looking at some issues about why certain companies chose not to bid. Yeah. There might be a different way to package this. We might put out a minimum amount that we'd be willing to guarantee for the business. The way we have it structured right now is it's a minimum of 3 inches before they get called out, and they're only called out as needed. A lot of contractors look at that, and they'll take a job elsewhere. They'd rather have a guarantee of parking lots or other places. So for us to go ahead and get these contractors, we may have to do something a little different with the bid.
And then when's the bid going to go out again?
Immediately.
Immediately, okay.
Yeah, we would hope to have this on the
agenda. Anyone out there wants to do some snow plowing, please do send us a bid. We'll be glad to take it.
Yes, we're hoping to go ahead and have this ready for you at your December meeting.
No, perfect.
Yeah, and I just want to say that I appreciate you guys moving so quickly on the violent sex offender registry.
Yeah, that was good.
I mean, you know, I felt, you know, horrible, and I really sympathize with the gentleman that came here at that previous meeting, and you guys are right on it, so I really
seems like a gap in the current law, which could be easily fixed. You already have the notification for the residences, and they have the data for the businesses, so they might as well just add that notification in there.
And I'd like to just to say that I'm very happy that we're finishing the process with the authorization to advertise for the ordinance for the codification adoption. Seems to be the final step, and that's very good for the residents.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there any other comment from the board on the consent agenda? Is there any from the public on the consent agenda? Seeing none, I'll call a question. All in favor of approving the consent agenda?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye.
Just want to point out that we talked about the Hartsville Fire Company. We have Ed Pfeiffer and Chief Gottschall here with us. And good evening, gentlemen. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for coming out. I know you guys had gone to zoning for your pole barn, and the staff was in harmony with giving a waiver of land development. So good luck with your work over there. I understand you guys have a couple of engineers that are that are volunteer firemen. So that was helpful. So the consent agenda is passed.
Okay, yep, all set. Chair, thank you.
We're good. Okay. I'm going to move on to the treasurer's report, Mr. Monroe.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have October transfers. I'm sorry. A bill list dated November 17th, 2016, in the amount of $1,900,061.86. I also have a supplemental bill list dated October 26, 2016, in the amount of $483,144.62. That's a total of $2,383,206.48. And I also have October transfers with a total of $9,674.91. I make a motion to approve those.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Ms. Frescatore, is there any comment from the board? None. Any comment from the public? Seeing none, I'll call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Motion carries. Okay, the next up is the budget amendment. I'm going to give that to Mr. Schuster for the budget amendment.
Thank you, Mr.
2016-47.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. This budget amendment is to take into account two projects. First, I'll call your attention. There is a revised resolution that was put on your desk based on some information that we got today. So the first project that this is allocating funds for is the stub road purchase. It was originally sent out to you at $425,000. We're increasing the appropriation to $432,000 to take into account closing costs based on the HUD statement that we received today. So that's one part of it. The second part is for a project involving our emergency services radio antenna. We're going to be relocating that antenna as soon as the FCC gives us the go-ahead with some new frequencies. Another part of this is getting upgraded equipment so that Public Works has the ability to use our radio system. Unfortunately, our Public Works crews right now don't have radio capability. They're usually mostly cell phones, which during a snowstorm, I would just say, is not the most desirable thing. You'd like for them all to have good communications and stay off their phones. So this is the allocation that we're requesting for these two projects.
Okay, so we're gonna need a motion to adopt the budget amendment 2016-47. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Mr. Crowley, is there a second?
Second.
Ms. Frescatore, is there any discussion? The board? Comments? Any from the public? Seeing none, I'll call the question. All in favor?
There was
I'm sorry.
Well, the dollar amount for the stub road purchase is $432,000. And the 18, and for the radio project, 18,840, is that correct, Joe? Thank you. I'm sorry, I didn't mention it, but there is one other thing. We're moving some funds over from the tree escrow into the general fund, or sorry, the rec fund, to go ahead and more tree work is. We're fighting with the Emerald Ash Bore.
So we have a motion and a second. Is there any more comment from the board?
No, sir.
Any from the public? I'm seeing none. I'll call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
The chair votes aye. Motion carries. Item C, the October financial statement. Mr. Schuster.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Continued good news. I'm not going to repeat what I say every single meeting, but expenditures still keep coming in under budget, and the revenues are over budget. As of the close of October, we have collected $3.6 million more in revenue than expenditures. So that's a pretty significant gap there. But please keep in mind, as we approach the end of the year, we do have some significant expenditures coming up. You just approved one of them, and we have some other payments going out for our pension funds, so that'll shorten that gap. But it is still shaping up to be a very good year financially.
Good. Awesome. It's good news. Okay, we'll move on to unfinished business. Authorized to advertise the 2017 Board of Supervisors proposed budget. And I'll give that to Mr. Schuster once again.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There's been two presentations by me so far at board meetings. You also had the budget workshop where we had a chance to go over the budget. At this point, the budget's ready for you to advertise for adoption on your December 15th meeting, if you're so inclined.
I mean, before we take any action on this, I mean, we did have a budget workshop that was open to the public where we reviewed the budget in detail. We actually reviewed it at our previous meeting. I mean, if the board is inclined to go into it any further, more discussion before we take any action.
I mean, I think there's value in maybe just highlighting some of the stuff that we're doing. Please.
I agree.
Yeah, I agree as well. So
absolutely.
I'm going to give that to you, Mr. Schuster, give an overview.
Well, the budget, first of all, there is no tax increase. It holds taxes steady. From a financial standpoint, it accomplishes several goals. One is we had a large deficit in the general fund, about $900,000. We've cut that by a third, so that's a very positive thing to do. And hopefully over the next couple of years, we'll be able to eliminate that deficit. Another thing we've been able to do that's very critical is shift the pension payment for the police plan from the smoothing method to the market value method, which is the preferred method. So we're no longer, I don't want to say underfunding, but not funding at the best rate. We're having put in away the right money for the police pension plan. Those two things are very critical in helping to get the budget in a more solid state. As far as operations, there's no real major change with our operations that I'm proposing. One thing is we are going to have one promotion in the police department, two lieutenant. That's not a new headcount. That's just a promotion, so the increased cost is marginal. It does get four new police cruisers, 5 miles of road work. We have included planning funds for the comprehensive plan that we're going to be kicking off in 2017. The golf fund continues to be positive. We know we've struggled for years with that, and it's going to be giving back at least $100,000 to the general fund. So those are just some of the very high-level items for this budget.
I think the incentives you've taken, Greg, with the smoothing method and a couple of the other incentives that you did with the budget this year is going to put us on better footing financially in the future, and I think we're going in the right direction. Thank you for that.
Thank you.
You've been the guy over there.
And I missed it. Did you mention the road paving?
5 miles.
Yeah, I was going to say it's doubling.
Right. Yes, due to the increase in liquid fuels, which will.
We've had a healthy increase in liquid fuels, and our own forces are doing the work now, rather than contracting out. We still contract out milling and some other work, but the actual paving is done by our own crew.
Right, who did a terrific job last year. We wrapped up the road program in August for the first time in many years. This past year, due to the efforts of Public Works and Eric Hines, our Public Works Director, where we were able to do some extra road paving. We went and did some work over at the golf course and in some of our parks, which we haven't done in years
did
past.
Did the alternate bids as well. So
Yes. We really had a good year this past year, and we're leading up with the increased liquid fuels. We're hoping to get more and more completed. Is there any other comment from the board? Mr. McPhillips?
So the budget does include a tax increase, four new police cruisers, and 5 miles of road. I think we talked about the budget workshop, but the four new police cruisers, what do we have, 27 in our fleet?
I believe that's, I saw the chief.
Chief just walked out the door, okay.
Yes, I believe that's what the, there he is.
Chief, and you're looking dapper tonight, by the way.
Chevy, chief.
Come on up, chief. As good as you're looking tonight, you got to get some FaceTime.
Chief, we were talking about the four new police cruisers.
Yes.
And in the fleet, we total police cruisers we have?
Well, when you talk about cruisers, you're talking about marked cars. 16 marked cars. Mm-hmm. We have 27 vehicles complete, including the trailers for speed trailers, couple of the county cars that we have issued to us. So in this upcoming year, four altogether, two. Most likely be marked, two will be on mark for admin because I have detectives' cars and admin cars I have to replace also. They're my detective cars are 1999s, so they need to get replaced overall. So
we were able to buy new cruisers, new cars last year. We're able to buy them this year, but I think we talked about this at the workshop. What I'm curious about is how many police cruisers, police vehicles are still over the recommended mileage per our insurance carrier. Our insurance carrier, that they evaluate our cruisers and they to everything from as far how much it's going to cost to maintain the vehicles to the safety of the vehicles. Because the more they go up in mileage, the less safe the vehicles are. So my question was, how many more vehicles are over the recommended mileage?
The detective's cars and the admin cars, they're not a 24-hour vehicle. So their mileage changes based on what their usage is. Out of the 16, there's probably 5, 6. Overall, out of the fleet, probably 12. That are over the mileage recommended. The mileage recommended by the insurance carrier is 75,000. We tend to get 125 out of them.
So we went from purchasing two to four. We are gradually getting caught up.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, you can't take it's a four vehicle rotation. And now we rest cars, we move cars. Like right now, with the purchase of these last few cars, I had enough to where I can. Work rest ratio. So the cars that are working right now from 7 o'clock tonight till 7 o'clock tomorrow morning will be off during the day tomorrow, and then they'll go back on tomorrow night. So they'll rest for 12. They won't run 24 hours to where they're running them into the ground.
Because we had some lean years where we didn't buy any cars at all.
Since 2010, 2011, we've run them 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, and ran some of them. I mean, go up to our road crew, you'll see them sitting up there. We ran them right into the ground.
So I guess the point I'm trying to make, though, and I know I'm not going to get an argument out of you, is that it's great that we're able to buy cruisers, but and I don't mean to get ahead of myself, but we're going to still need to replenish our fleet with cruisers.
Small bikes.
Small bikes.
Saeed Elf, small bikes. Right. So. All right.
Thanks, Chief. I appreciate it.
Chief, did I happen to hear that ShopRite might be doing another incentive to buy another police vehicle?
Where'd you hear that?
That's the first time. I
heard it.
They might be doing an upcoming fundraiser.
I have no idea.
You haven't heard?
No.
I'm going to put a little bug in there.
We have an event coming up.
Wants to get her picture on that mural in there.
I shop in there all the time, so I'll put a little bug in there.
I'm not going to say no, but I mean, that's a surprise, so. I'll have to call Joe tomorrow.
It must be a rumor then. I just wanted to clarify.
Yeah, rumors are great. As long as they turn into facts, we're good.
Thank you, Chief.
Thanks, Chief.
Is there any other discussion from the board before we turn it to the public? No, go ahead. Have some more? Go ahead.
The 5 miles of road, did we, this is something we talked about at the workshop. Do we identify which 5 miles of road we're going to pave?
Not yet. We're getting there. In fact, I'm hoping at your next meeting, if not the next meeting, the first one, or not your reorg, but the first real meeting in January, to have that road plan presented to you by the Public Works Director. So it's almost finalized.
And the Director of Public Works said he wants to do different sections of the township?
Yeah, when you go ahead and do these road programs, a lot of times it's better to pick out sections just so you're not running all over town. You can group your forces in one area and really concentrate. Then again, there's sometimes you have to spread it out because if roads are in such poor condition you just have to go ahead and address them. But if it's possible and the road conditions allow for it, when you have a lot of small roads, you know, those those are the tough ones in those neighborhoods. You try to just do a neighborhood at a time because it can be disruptive when you get in there, and we'd rather get up there and disrupt it for a short period of time than be back there every other year doing some other road. So we tend to like to group them if possible.
I'm just, correct me if I'm wrong, though, we're voting to put money aside for roads we haven't identified yet?
Correct.
Okay.
But it's, well, the money's already coming because it's liquid fuels yes. funds, so it's not actually tax dollars in this case.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's, and I guess the, not to keep going back to this workshop, but the other thing we talked about is the need for a full-time adult services librarian, and I know the board was very receptive to that, and hopefully, if not this year, possibly next year, the board can consider that.
Yeah, it's something, as I said during the budget workshop, I agree with the sentiment. We have a problem because the adult services librarian is used so much that having a full-time librarian would be preferable. Also, whoever we get in there is in a part-time basis, they leave as soon as they get a full-time job, so it becomes a revolving door. We're going to look at the personnel structure. We're anticipating some personnel changes that could occur throughout the year, and we would take advantage of that to do something that is budget neutral. If that doesn't occur, then I can go ahead and present other options to you. But I agree 100% with the sentiment that we should have a full-time adult services librarian. It's just the funding mechanism that I'm struggling with right now.
Okay, and then sticking with the library, the HVCA system.
Yeah,
we're going to be putting a grant for that. Do we know the status of that grant?
The grant has been submitted, and we're waiting. Okay. I don't know exactly when we'll hear. It won't be any time in the immediate future, but we're waiting to hear back on that. Yes.
Okay, we'll keep our fingers crossed.
Absolutely, the HVAC system is quite expensive, and I believe it's a 50% grant, so we would still have to go ahead and pay some money. But it's at the end of its life, and it's something we're going to have to do anyways.
Great.
Well, hopefully the grant will come through, save us a couple of bucks.
I certainly hope so.
Is there any more discussion from the board before I open it up to the public? Is there any from the public before we take action to advertise a preliminary budget? Ms. Giroux, I see you have your hand raised there. Come on up.
Hello again. I just wanted to come as a member of the Friends of the Library. I was very disappointed, of course, that we couldn't get the funding that we needed. But yet, as a resident of Warminster, I love the idea that we were able to have no tax increase for everyone. So I understand the idea of priorities and needs, and I appreciate the work that everyone here has done to bring in this budget. I mean, it's not an easy task, and sometimes you have to split the baby, and unfortunately, I find myself, my wants to be on the wrong side, but such is life. When you were speaking tonight, Mr. Schuster, when you were talking about maybe the personnel structure and the budget, that it would, if you could do some budget neutral changes, that would be a wonderful thing. And Director Linder has been working hard and long for, well, it was 2012 when a position was made part time. So we're talking 5 years if we're talking 2017 budget, and while that would be a wonderful thing to get the adult services librarian into a full time position. I ask you to keep in mind that we would love to have something budget neutral, but I don't know that that's really possible for just to keep that in the forefront. If not for now, we would just be playing a game with the nutshells, just moving them all over. If we move personnel around to put a part-time position into a full-time position, then that full-time position that isn't there anymore is we're still left with a hole. So I need to when I don't want to say when I bug you, but when I engage
okay.
you
it's
on
okay.
this,
yeah. We're used to it.
Want to say to restore the full-time position that was put to part-time in 2012, to restore that position to a full-time position, whether it be as an adult services librarian or whatever in there. So I appreciate your keeping an eye on that, and hopefully we'll be in a better position.
And as we discussed at the workshop, I think the board and the administration's committed to looking some creative ways of doing this.
And I appreciate that. Yeah, that is the truth. I agree with that, Mark.
We have a phenomenal library, and you do great services outreach in the community. And if there's any way possible that we can find a way to get you that service, we will certainly do so.
And I understand that, and I believe your sincerity, and that's, I don't mean to be beating you over the head all the time, but just tonight when you were talking about that situation that may or may not come about, we're moving personnel around. If you take a part-time position, a full-time position now, and move her to part-time or him or whomever, and you still are minus one, mm-hmm. you know, 20 hours.
Jerry, you mentioned about, and please don't be hesitant to bugging us. Remember, we work for you.
Yeah. Well, as you know, I sometimes feel a little bad because I'm always harping on it, but not bad enough that I stop. Don't worry about that.
Well, you treated me very kind at the charity ball the other night, and I do appreciate it.
You're very nice when you bug us, too.
Thank you. I do appreciate your hard work and on behalf of the library and the township. I realize if you could, you would. So I'm just going to help you try and find a way that you can.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jerry.
Thank you.
Is there any other comment from the public on the proposed budget before we take action to advertise it? Okay, seeing none, I'm going to ask for a motion to advertise the 2017 Board of Supervisors proposed budget.
Motion.
Ms. Frescatore, is there a second?
Second.
Mr. McPhillips, is there any other discussion from the board?
No.
None from the public? Okay, I'll call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Motion carries. Advertise the budget.
Thank you.
That's good. Okay. We are going to move along to new business. Item A, review land development 16-08, Lidl, preliminary and final land development approval. Mr. Savona.
Mr. Chairman, this is, as you've indicated, this is the time set for consideration of the land development application 16-08. The applicant is Lidl US LLC, 2005 Market Street, Suite 1010, Philadelphia, PA, seeking approval of preliminary and final plan for property located at 700 York Road. The site is approximately 9.1 acres, located within the C2 Commercial 2 Zoning District, currently consisting of a one-story 56,651 square foot masonry building and a 429 space parking lot with associated driveways and stormwater management. The application proposes the demolition of the existing building and parking lot to construct a 35,962 square foot grocery store, a use 27 retail shop, which is permitted by right in the C2. Additional site improvements include a 180 space parking lot, driveways, stormwater managements, etc. The applicant is present this evening, represented by Attorney George Brosman of Kaplan Stewart. Mr. Brosman, you prepared to proceed?
Yes, good evening. I'm George Brosman, representing the applicant. With me is Scott Logan from Lidl.
Hello, Scott.
And Kevin McCartney from Bowler.
Over there is probably the best place for that, so the camera can pick it up.
Ooh, good catch.
Give us 1 second. Face it this way. Scott, I want to face it this way so that camera can pick it up for the folks at home.
Wow, there is that.
So Mr. Savona did a good job of summarizing. In a nutshell, it's an abandoned grocery store site, and Lidl would put a...
Move it over toward the podium a little, Scott, please. Sorry. Just want to make sure the folks at home, it gets up on the monitor so the people here can see it as well.
Mr. McKee.
It looks like a good spot.
Good?
Lidl would put a new, smaller store there. Scott is here to tell you a little bit about Lidl, if you're interested in hearing about that.
We
and
are.
Kevin from Bowler can tell you about the site plan, but in a nutshell, it's a smaller building, less impervious coverage, and we think a good redevelopment. There are some waivers that we've requested. Most are technical matters. We do have a letter that we could give to your solicitor that Bowler prepared that lists in one place all of the waivers that we are asking for. It's my understanding that they've been recommended for approval by your planning commission. So with that, I would like Scott maybe to tell you a little
Scott.
Bit about Lidl, and then we can go over the site plan.
Thanks. In case you need it. Whatever you're comfortable with.
Thank you again for having us this evening.
My name's Scott Logan. I'm a development manager with Lidl US. We are a German-based grocery chain coming to the United States.
I don't think the mic's on, Scott. Check it. Check both. Make sure both switches are on.
There you go. There
we go. Thank you. We are a German-based grocery chain. We are in 27 European countries. We have over 10,000 stores. We are new to the U.S. So while we're not a household name here, we certainly are overseas. We describe ourselves as a premium private label grocer. What that means is we provide mostly Lidl branded goods, but we strive to provide the highest quality product at the best possible prices in the most convenient locations. We will have some national brands, but we are primarily Lidl branded goods. We opened our first store in the early 70s, and again, we've expanded throughout Europe and are now over 10,000 units strong. We basically are looking for existing retail corridors where we feel there's a need for our goods and our services. I personally am a resident of Warminster, so I'm extremely familiar with the site. Our engineer can talk a little bit about our location, but we all know it was Pathmark years ago. It's been Waterloo Gardens and 263 Marketplace. We're looking to clean the site up. I don't want to steal too much of Mr. McCartney's story this evening, but as you can see by the color rendering there, we're really actually getting rid of the existing structure, trying to beautify the site. We have a freestanding building. It's about 36,000 square feet. We'll show you renderings throughout the night. A lot of natural light, real tasteful architectural look to the building. So we're excited to be coming to the township. I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
How many jobs is this going to bring?
The typical Lidl store, we'd anticipate about 30 to 35 between part-time and full-time employees. Average shift, maybe 7 to 10 employees. We don't have any open in the U.S. yet. The expansion is still underway. We have offices and have secured sites from Pennsylvania, New Jersey, south through Georgia. We have offices in Texas we've just recently opened. So we have several under construction down south, but none open to use as a case study. But just based on the size, it is much larger than our European store. Again, that 36,000 square foot, it's about double what we have in Europe, but it's significantly smaller than what we would consider a supermarket, you know, in our area. So we don't really have a base model as far as, you know, employment or, you know, exact number of trucks per day. Things of that nature will kind of flesh themselves out over time. If we needed to staff up, we certainly would, but we think the average shift would have 7 to 10 people. We're anticipating one, maybe two trucks a day, again, based on our store size. Looking to be open similar hours to other retailers in the market right now, looking targeting 8 a.m. to 10 p.m.
So that's one or two deliveries a day?
Yes, sir.
Typically 18-wheelers?
Yes. Yeah, okay. Full-size, a WB67 as it's described. Yeah, full-size tractor trailer. Yes, sir. Great.
What's your target date to be open?
I can't really speak to that precisely. I can tell you a year or two ago, we were trying to push it out because we wanted to get a certain amount online. We didn't have distribution centers set up, that sort of thing. I can tell you it's become a lot more real. We have a distribution center that's completed in outside of Raleigh, North Carolina, waiting for the stores to be ready. We have one in Fredericksburg, Virginia that's almost complete that would probably service here, even though that seems far to you and me, probably in the short term until we had a distribution center farther north that was ready to go. We have one in Perryville, Maryland that is under construction, but it takes about 18 months for the distribution centers to be built. The store takes more like 6 or 7 months.
We have some nice light industrial areas in Warminster if you're interested in setting up shop for a distribution center.
I'll pass that along,
as well.
Mr. McKee.
Please do.
I can tell you on behalf of our Board of Supervisors and our residents, this can't happen soon enough. It's been an eyesore, that area in the township, for quite a while. You as a resident,
I feel the same.
And it looks beautiful. So we really welcome you into the township and can't wait for it to open.
Thank you. Yeah, our public statement has been all along, you'll see the first U.S. stores open no later than 2018. I can tell you we have one under construction in South Jersey that we just broke ground on. It's really based on how quickly we can get through entitlement. So obviously the longest lead item here would be DOT, but we're maintaining the existing access points. We have our traffic engineer who could talk about that if there's any concerns. But we, as soon as we're through DOT, we'd be excited to put it out to bid and get started.
Thank you.
You're welcome. My understanding is that most of the architecture from store to store differs pretty much, right? It's not like a cookie cutter. You guys put a little bit extra thought into the architecture.
It's our stores are all very similar, but you were comparing us to other grocers or other retailers.
Okay, no, I thought I saw some different renderings from different stores, and I thought they were quite different.
Mr. McCartney has those actually right here. We've got one view of what the front of the store would look like. Mm-hmm. We do have one store built. We built one early in Fredericksburg, also near the distribution center that's being built.
just to make sure, basically we used it to stage our equipment and make sure that the layout worked operationally, and we've kind of tweaked it as we've gone to construction on other sites. But as you can see, a lot of glass. That front curtain wall is what would be facing York Road. It's a corner entry building, so the right side of the building there would face north, which would face the majority of our parking. So really kind of two fronts. It'll have the two wall signs. And the sloping roof is something you really don't see with really any retailer, but we like that it sets us apart from other, again, not just grocers, but other retailers. We are purchasing the site. The building is clearly not your typical vanilla box. It's pretty exciting architecturally. We're making a long-term commitment to the township. We definitely want to be here.
Yeah, we're glad to have you.
I'm sorry.
No, that's quite all right. Go ahead,
Kat. Mr. Chair. Anyway, you could just turn it around so the folks that are here, they could take a look too.
They can see it on the TV.
Oh, yeah, you can see it?
Yeah, it's
oh,
up
okay.
on the monitor.
Oh, great.
That's why we
oh, great.
It there.
Okay,
looks
great.
Good up there.
Thank you.
It does.
It looks really good.
I heard, when I first heard Lytle months and months and months ago, I went up on the website and perused around, and that was something that I was very excited about, so I'm glad to hear it.
We have, because we were somewhat secretive about the expansion or just weren't sharing too many details up front, we wanted to make sure we knew where we were going and would actually have answers to some of the basic questions, if you will. A lot of people were doing their homework as they heard, you know.
It was the worst kept secret in Warminster,
yes,
that's for sure.
There were several, you know, every news article has a different picture of a lead, so they're plucking them from our Ireland stores and our, you know, our German stores, and they're all a little different, so maybe that's what you had seen. Over time, I'm sure we'll have many prototypes, such as, you know, Wawa's and McDonald's do, and they evolve over time. Because of how rapidly we're looking to expand, it would be challenging to have multiple footprints, so we really just have this one-size store for now. You know, nothing says down the road we couldn't, you know, have an inline store. Or Mr. McKee had approached me months, if not a year or so ago, about the vacant Acme space, which is near my house. Unfortunately, we just don't retrofit yet, but, you know, down the road that might be something for us. So,
thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I have the all-important operational question for you. Anybody who follows me on Facebook knows that I make my way around town on Sunday by who gives out the free samples. You guys going to do, is that what type of business you have, like the other grocers where they have the station set up?
I think they're still trying to formulate.
I'm still going to stop in the store anyway.
The strategy, yeah. I'm sure we're still formulating a strategy as to, even product line is still being finalized, but I'm confident that for VIPs we would be able to.
Well, no, I just wanted to kind of set up you guys
I'm
up.
Teasing,
you know?
But I'm sure that we would have, that's the best way to turn people onto your product, right? Would be to give them small samples, and that's kind of the way that most grocers are trending, so I can't imagine that we wouldn't.
Awesome, awesome. Yeah, I have to say I'm really looking forward to this. This is a terrific use for this property, but I'm jumping ahead here.
Thank
I know you.
You
guys want to cover the nuts and bolts.
That's a good segue.
Perfect.
Speaking of nuts and bolts.
Absolutely. Let me back this board. So as we've already covered, the site is on York Road, 700. York Road is the address. To the north and west is Christ Home. Across the street is the Archbishop Wood High School. Again, like everyone has been saying, we are drastically decreasing the impervious by approximately 40% from what is currently on the site. We are still maintaining new stormwater management systems in addition to the existing basin that is located approximately in this area here. The parking and square footage of the store also is reduced. So I think that covers about it. Obviously, there's lighting, landscaping that's also being proposed as part of the development. Other than that, I think that.
Well, I like that you're greening the property up, you know, which you are correct. You are reducing the impervious, correct?
Yes.
I really like that.
We love green.
I was going to mention about the greening up. There is no restriction to develop the other portion of the site, though, unless that's on the table to be deed restricted. But I believe they want to keep that open.
Right. So I can touch on that. That's correct. We typically need about 4, maybe 4.5 acres for our building and associated parking. It's obviously a larger parcel. Do you know approximately how large it is?
It's about 9 acres.
So it's certainly more acreage than we need. We weren't looking to be piggish or come in here and put potential what-if scenario buildings and max parking and stormwater design only to, you know, subdivide it and sell to somebody else who has a different vision for it. We're in the grocery business. I'm actually a Lidl employee. I'm not a developer looking to hopefully get a Lidl here someday. We're only interested in opening a grocery store. So if and when we'd like the opportunity to be able to carve it off, if it meets the requirements of the ordinance and someone can develop it, great. They would obviously at that point be required to meet
you know, the current zoning ordinance at that time, but we're not looking to subdivide at this time. We really just wanted to get rid of the old parking lot, make it green for now, and then again, if and when down the road. We would hope to not be deed restricted so that we would have that opportunity if we chose to, but certainly not a plan of ours at this time.
Hours of operation are going to be?
We're looking at 8 to 10. That's the what's being floated around internally right now.
Okay.
We're certainly not a 24-hour type of use, and I can't imagine we'd really be open longer hours than that. If we've had to commit to capping the hours in townships, we've done that, but 8 to 10 would be what we're striving for.
Okay, and then getting in and out of the, it's just the one in it, egress? Or?
There's a signalized intersection located here, which is an existing intersection. And then there's a right in, right out.
So it's pretty much going to remain the same.
It's going to remain the same access points as currently exist today.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to ask Mr. Savona, when he said that perhaps to have somebody else come in down the road, you don't foresee that being a problem, correct?
It really would depend on what the plan was down the road. I mean, at this point, they have enough property at 9 acres, 9 plus or minus acres, to more than accommodate the development that they've proposed. If and when they did come to try to subdivide, they would have to be able to demonstrate that they could still meet the impervious surface limits and the building coverage limits and all that. And that's really, you know, it's speculative. They may want to expand at some point in the future. They may come back and they may need the property.
There are options then. So.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
The only waiver that they're asking for the future development is not to analyze stormwater and design the stormwater facilities for maximum impervious, which wouldn't make sense anyway, but that's how your ordinance
is written. They'd be required to do that at time. It's up to
them. So we'll go through that. It's you know, you hear waiver of stormwater management, everybody, you know, what are we doing? But that's just for the future part of that, and it's unknown. So why have them design it and you don't know what the end product is? So that'll be on the new developer, or if they subdivide or expand, they'll have to meet new stormwater regulations at that time.
Okay. So unless there's other
oh, I'd like to
prefatory
see if
remarks.
I'd like to see if there's any from the public.
Well, I was going to go through the waivers first.
Okay, if you want to go through the waivers and then.
We have a number of waivers. The applicant has submitted a waiver request letter. It's updated to November the 17th, 2016. There are approximately 16 waivers. First, Mr. Brosman, if I could. The township has been in receipt of a number of review letters from the township engineer, the zoning officer, the fire marshal, the township's traffic engineer, the county planning commission, and the township's planner. With the exception of the waivers that you've requested in the waiver letter, I'm safe in assuming that Lidl will agree to comply with those comments to the extent that they're deemed necessary by the township engineer?
Yes, that's right.
All right, so then let's turn to the specific requested waivers. I'd like to just run through these quickly. Applicants requesting a waiver for combined preliminary and final approval under Section 301.2. Mr. Kennard, any issues?
No objection.
All right. Partial waiver from Section 4063B to utilize an aerial image for the location names and widths of streets, sanitary storm sewers, et cetera, within 400 feet of the subject property. This is a common waiver. Mr. Kennard, any issues?
No.
Will the applicant, Mr. Brosman, agree to supply any details that are required by the township engineer?
Yes.
And just for the record, we've gone through a re-review already, so we're in this situation, I think we're pretty good on the design, the layout. I don't think just too many things are going to be changing here after if you get preliminary final tonight. So,
agreed.
But I'd like to reserve that right.
Next is a waiver from Section 510.4C to allow the southern driveway width to exceed 35 feet at the ultimate right-of-way and 54 feet at the curb line. What's the basis for that request?
The basis of that request is really just to maintain the existing access point that is there. We're reducing it from what currently exists by just bringing in the curb lines and putting what's commonly referred to as a pork chop island.
Right.
You know, to restrict people from making a left in.
Okay.
But it's really just to keep the access point that's there.
Any issues, Mr. Kennard?
No, we support that design.
Next is a waiver from Section 510.4D to allow the cross-access driveway to be placed within 15 feet of the side yard setback. Could you point out for the board where that's located?
Sure. It is this property right down, or this corner of property here.
Okay. Is that a function of the existing condition?
Yeah, actually, I guess we all skipped over that internal connection. The applicant and this is, I don't know if they planned to do it originally. It was at staff level. There's always been discussed if that was redeveloped, but it's connection to the Warminster Plaza parking lot. So there's actually an internal connection. So you can go from, it'll be connected right near Sportsplex. There'll be some modifications. They need to have, I don't know if it's temporary easements or not, but then there'll be a permanent cross easement. So you will be able to go from the grocery store to Sportsplex down to AAA without going out to York Road.
Great idea.
And we understand that was one of the comments in the review letter, make sure we had that right. We've been in contact with the owner. He's absolutely in support of it, and we understand he's actually undertaking some improvements there currently. Mm-hmm. So unfortunately, we'll figure out the timing. He may be putting in sidewalk that we then take out a few months later to put our cross connection. But in any case, we've already had those discussions.
And he just contacted our office,
oh, good,
I think this week, to work on phase two of the sidewalk. So our office will try to coordinate between the two projects to make sure we got the design.
Minimizing how much we have to take out. After, so. Yeah.
There are existing easements in place for those cross-access connections, sure.
Yeah, I believe there is an easement, and you know, we would just, if we had to, we would modify that.
You can verify that.
Yes.
Next is a waiver from 512.9 to permit the use of curb radii less than 5 feet.
No issues with that.
What is the, just so I know the scope of the waiver, what's the proposed radii?
It's really just for a small portion of really two locations. This island back here that is near the loading dock area, and it's all concrete. The second area is over here where it's a depressed curb situation and next to the ADA stalls.
It's not within the parking area, so.
Next is a waiver from section 513.1 to not extend sidewalk along the York Road frontage. I'm going to bundle that with another waiver you've requested later, section 809, to not extend York Road along the, or the sidewalk, I'm sorry, along the York Road frontage. Could you explain the reason for the requested waivers?
So currently under, and I'm going to flip to the existing conditions quickly. As I mentioned before, there's an existing stormwater management basin that is currently on the portion of this property here. And there's a number of existing headwalls and end walls that are adjacent to the roadway. If we were to try to install any sidewalk along this portion of the frontage, there would be significant, you know, changes that we would have to make, a lot of trees that we would have to take down in order to install that sidewalk. The other aspect of it is once you get past the property frontage here, there's no other existing sidewalk that takes you anywhere else.
What's the approximate linear footage of sidewalk you're asking for to be waived?
It would be, I guess nothing.
And while Kevin's doing the calculation, early on when we had met with the zoning board, there was a recommendation to connect through the property to the west, to the Christ Home property. They have a path that kind of ends at the end of our property. We had agreed that we would do that. Christ Home came out and said they did not want the cross connection. They really didn't want the residents leaving the property, and they said it'd be hard to manage. They also don't have sidewalk to the north there for us to connect to, so that was part of our thought in this. Again, there are some design challenges Kevin touched on. I'll let him.
It was 240 linear feet.
Typically, the township would ask for a fee in lieu of any sidewalk that's not being constructed. Mr. Brosman, any issue with that?
That's up to Lidl, I guess, is that?
We actually had mentioned that at the Planning Commission as well, that if we couldn't fit it, we'd be happy to make a contribution in case the township came through later and found a way.
And Christ Homes Community Center project that is adjacent to that open area of the basin, if the board recalls, I think last month you granted the same waiver. It's difficult to build sidewalk. We're coordinating again projects, so they agreed to a fee in lieu of the sidewalk. We did ask for Lidl to install sidewalk up until a certain point, and then it gets difficult. You can't install it. So there will not be sidewalk in that area of York Road due to the existing features.
Work out the fee in lieu of at staff level?
Yeah, we'll do that at staff level. We'll make sure the number's right, or the linear footage, and then we have your typical fee, so.
The next waiver is from 513.1 to provide a 5-foot wide sidewalk along York Road.
It's the same thing.
The same thing?
Yeah. All right. Section 513.1 and section 809, we'll lump all three waivers together as far as waiving all other public improvements You've shown improvements along your main frontage there, and the rest will be waived, and the fee in lieu of will be tied to the sidewalk, as was done in the past, so.
Very good. 521.1B, to permit the design and installation of stormwater management system based on the actual impervious coverage rather than the maximum. That's the waiver Mr. Kenner referred
to. Yes, I mentioned that earlier. Again, the ordinance requires them to develop to the maximum impervious of the site. They're only using about half the site. So as mentioned earlier, the green space where the existing basin is, we support waiving that requirement to design it at this time. That'll be up to the engineer at the time if they do any future development or they subdivide and then, you know, sell off that lot and develop it at a later time. So, but we would not require this applicant to design that stormwater management system.
Waiver from the requirements of 521.2D to permit the use of pipes less than 15 inches in a private storm sewer system. Any issue with that, Mr. Kenner?
No, it's just yard drains and smaller roof drain connections, so that's no issue there.
Next, we have a waiver from 523.5C to permit fewer than the required plantings along the southern and eastern property lines.
We have no issues with that either. There's some existing vegetation, and in fact, I think they've done a good job on landscaping on the perimeter, so that would be a waiver.
You also have waivers from 523.6D&E and 523.7C that all relate to plantings within the parking lot and the basin areas. You're just asking to comply with what's there now and what's proposed in the plan, correct?
Correct.
Any issues with
that? I do. I would like to separate those. Okay. 523.6D related to the parking area. I've been going back and forth on what meets the definition of landscaping. They like to just keep some areas green and no shrubs, plantings. I would agree, and we have not granted that waiver in the past. Typically, there's shrubs, small trees, ornamental trees. Well, I would agree tonight to do a partial waiver we can work out. We don't need to fully landscape the parking areas, but I'd like to see a little bit more than what's there. So that would be a partial waiver subject to the scope approved by my office. The basin landscaping, the following waiver, yes, they planted that. Any more plantings would actually probably die, so I would support a waiver of 523.7C.
Okay. The partial waiver is only from 523.6D&E.
Yeah.
Any issue with that, Mr. Prosman?
I think we can work that out.
Very good. You're next asking for a waiver from 524.5G to permit maximum illuminance greater than 0.2 foot candles along the southern property line. Want to explain that waiver, please?
Sure. That waiver is strictly because of the proximity of the building on the back and the sidewalk that runs along the back of the building and the lighting that we have on the building itself to provide, you know, the safety for any Lidl employee that needs to use that sidewalk. In addition to that, what currently exists on the neighboring property is a parking area that has existing lights and poles in that area that have an infringement on the property or on our property. It is also exceeded, so.
All right. Would you have any idea what the proposed maximum that you're asking for? So you're asking to vary from the 0.2. What limit are you proposing?
Up to 1 foot candle.
To one.
Yeah. Up to one?
Yes, 1.0 foot candles.
And as Kevin said, we have wall sconces there on the building, so it's not like it's not big pole lots in the parking lot. It's the wall sconces. They're not even that high, but they do have some spillover. Sure. And we have a sidewalk out there. It's emergency egress, as well as if anything needs to be maintained for our rooftop equipment, that sidewalk's there. So we do need the lighting. I don't think we could eliminate them, or we'd have dark spots on our side.
So let's loop around. Because
on sheet 9, Mr. Savona, of our plan, there's the foot candles are shown, if you want to refer to that. And okay. Without my glasses, I can't see the numbers, but you could. A younger person could.
Do you need more light?
Yeah, it's ironic.
Nice.
Yeah. So, since you're asking for a waiver to go up to 1 foot candle, one of the comments that's in the township engineer's review letter that wasn't addressed in your waiver requests, it's item 19 in the November 9th review letter, section 524.4F. That section of the SALDO requires all non-security lighting be extinguished between the hours 11 p.m. and 7 a.m. and that not more than 25% of all lighting fixtures on site be considered security lighting. We have not identified whether you intend to comply or not with that provision, so we, since this is preliminary and final.
We were going to comply with that.
Right. So I'm going to make the any waiver of 524.5G subject to your compliance with that requirement of the ordinance. Mm.
And in addition, what we've typically done in the past is, obviously, a condition would be any complaints. I don't think you'll get it in this situation, but if we do receive any complaints from the neighbors, that you would address those to satisfaction of the township engineer at any time in the future. Typically, I'm going to get a lighting as-built plan when you're done, and everybody's usually higher, and that's a condition anyway. So, and this is a little higher than we've usually gone, but I understand your situation with the neighbor there. So that would just be a condition that any complaints would be addressed to satisfaction of the township engineer.
That's acceptable to us.
Very good.
I won't pretend to be a lighting expert, but there's a way to
I'm
dim
not
them.
Either.
They're all LED. If there's a way to dim them, we can always dim them. Yeah. But we have agreed to the security lighting that Mr. Savona touched on.
And we think, you know, their light is probably coming onto our property.
Oh, I'm sure they're
probably.
Well, they probably won't be. I'm assuming they won't complain now.
Yeah.
next is a request from the requirement, their waiver from the requirements of section 604.5A to not provide a recreation trail. The recreation trail you're referring to would have been where?
The recreational trail would have been, there's an existing recreational trail that is in the Christ Homes development.
Okay,
currently.
So that's the one you referenced earlier.
That's the one I touched on previously, yes.
Right. And that's a Christ Homes request.
Yes, and that was discussed with the Planning Commission. I believe zoning as well, but
yes.
The commission, the Christ Home had asked that not be made.
Very good. Any issue with that, Mr.
No.
Ritter? We've already covered 809. The last is a stormwater ordinance waiver, section 303.C from the Neshaminy Creek Act 160 or 167 ordinance to not provide treatment of the for the entire water quality volume. Mr. Kennard, any issue with that?
They can't meet or they don't have enough, achieve enough infiltration rates out there to percolate. So it wouldn't be a good design to sit there and try to address water quality with poor infiltration in that area. So this is another standard waiver we do. They prove that they can't infiltrate, and I would support that waiver.
Okay. That's it as far as the requested waivers and exceptions. Mr. Brosman, anything else on behalf of Lita?
Nothing other than what we would ask that we be granted the preliminary final approval with the waivers subject to our discussion this evening.
Mr. Chairman, any other questions from the board?
So before you craft a motion for us, I'm going to ask if there's any more from the board and from the public. So we'll go for the board first. Is there any further? I think we've all covered it. Is there any input from the public? Would anyone like to? Sure, come on up.
Nothing against any German restaurant.
And you are? Please give your name.
George Lewis. My concern is the traffic. There's only one way to go north on York Road. It's the Roberts Road, which is, I can't see where is that.
Right, so it's the one up above. Yes,
Roberts
right
Road.
There, correct.
It's going to be rough because you have to make a serpentine go out there. It definitely should have an easement, which you address that, right?
Mm-hmm.
On both things. You're all the way down to 3A. There's no way going north. There's one opening there, and you have to cross two lanes of traffic, and they're going south. They're about 45 miles an hour. I know I go a little faster than that, Chief, but I've seen people pass me at 50, at least, or 60, going south on York Road. And there's an opening there right by the sports. You can cross over two lanes of traffic and head north. That's a dangerous intersection. This does not get the traffic out fast enough to York, to Roberts Road. Mm-hmm. And I say, I'm not against the grocery store. My wife shops at the other here in the grocery store. I won't mention the name. But I feel this plan is makes you serpentine from wherever you're going in here, all the way through this traffic, and all the way out here again. And I don't care if you're a sports complex, if you're a swimming pool complex, if you're, what else is in there? Dry cleaners. There is absolutely no way to go north except that one opening mm-hmm. they have at that sports complex. You cross over two lanes and go north. But that's up to you guys.
Yeah, actually, that's PennDOT. They will need to obtain PennDOT permit. They may have to alter their design, and then depending on PennDOT's comments and the.
Well, I have to talk to PennDOT then because this gets you making serpentine all around this parking lot with people putting grocery baskets out to go out to York Road. Thank you for your time.
I think there is, though. Right, just to the south, that one exit right there. No, a little bit further south, the other way. Right there.
Yes.
There is a cut through. There's a concrete median.
The only cut through, you cross over two lanes.
Right.
And make a left to go north.
Yeah, it's dangerous there.
And that is very dangerous there. I tried to get
them myself. PennDOT will require them to put a signal in there.
So
they won't. Now you come down at 50 miles an hour, you know it says 45.
Right. So you're saying that everyone is going to want to go to the traffic light?
I would.
Yeah.
I do.
Okay.
It's safer. You can try to shoot across two lanes, and also being careful somebody going north at 45 miles, 50 mm-hmm. miles an hour.
So we don't have control over that, Craig, if I may ask.
I don't
it's
know
up
does.
To PennDOT, you're saying? Okay.
But it's very dangerous to get out of that parking lot. I don't care where you're at in that parking lot. Right.
It's valid.
Yeah. And PennDOT's aware. We've had other projects in the area, a lot over in Street Road, that whole intersection.
They should have a path on this side, right by the road, and go out at York Road.
The only input this board would have is if PennDOT requires a significant change to the layout as far as the egress, ingress and egress, impact the layout, and then it's my job to say, hey, you got to need to come back for board reapproval. I highly doubt that, but PennDOT will probably work with them on limitations of access. I don't see another signal. You mentioned another signal. I don't see another signal. It's too close to the existing signal, so they have their limitations on that. So. I'm not sure what, I don't know if you've met with PennDOT yet.
Traffic engineer.
Oh, there you go.
We have our traffic engineer. I would point out, I think it's obvious, the store is being made smaller than what was there, and we are dealing with PennDOT, but I'll let Corey address that briefly.
Thank you.
Thanks. Corey Chase with Atlantic Traffic. We did have a scoping application with PennDOT, and we have actually filed a formal HOP. We've already received their feedback on the layout and the design, given the reduction in building square footage associated with the site, they had a favorable review of it, and they, you know, the access is concentrated primarily at the signalized access point, which is their preference as well. So they saw the redevelopment of the site as a positive, the reduction in overall building square footage, and then maintaining the two existing access points.
I do remember in the past when we had multiple stores there, most people did use the light because that is the safest way to exit. Thank you.
Thanks.
Excuse me. Please can you please come up so the folks can hear, please?
The question is whether it's just their project. The question is, PennDOT's reviewing only the new development.
Or the whole lot.
Just
all the way down.
When you say all the way down, you mean Warminster Plaza, AAA?
All the way down.
This separate application that's already been approved. That's a different owner. And PennDOT did sign off on all those improvements as well.
Sure, please come on up.
John Priobos, 674 Joseph Avenue, Warminster, Pennsylvania. I just have a couple questions about this spot. I like the idea. I think it's great. I think they downsized it for future development. That's one thing in mind. I'm sure you have a pretty large parcel off on the north side of the property and around the back. I think we should look a little ahead of what they're going to probably do down the road. They're probably going to subdivide, sell it off. I know on a C2, I think we can put car washes in, mini marts, gas station or gas pumps. I think it's a consideration that we may not want to put that in that location because of the neighborhood and the way it looks. And I think it's a positive step forward, but I also think we should protect what we have down the road. We don't need a gas station or filling stations and things like that on every corner in Warminster. I think we should look for the aesthetic part of it, which is what they're trying to do, but we want to protect ourselves as residents down the road that we don't see this every time. Okay?
No, understood.
Thank you.
Are there any other comments from the public? Any input? Anyone here? Certainly up for it. Any other input? Okay, well, I'm going to ask Mr. Savona to craft a motion.
Well, Mr. Chairman, if the board's inclined, the motion would be in order to approve the application numbered as Township Application LD 16-08 for Lidl US LLC for preliminary final land development approval for 700 York Road, tax map parcel 49-009-043, subject to the applicant's compliance with all of the comments contained in the review letters of the Township Engineer, the Township Zoning Officer, the Township Fire Marshal, the Township Traffic Engineer, the Bucks County Planning Commission, and the Township Planner, except to the extent that such requirements are waived. In accordance with the requested waivers detailed in the township or the applicant's November 17th, 2016 waiver request letter, those waivers, numbering 16 in number, I won't repeat them again, but those waivers would be granted subject to compliance with the following additional conditions: that the applicant would provide such site details as required by the township engineer, that the applicant would pay a fee in lieu of the installation of sidewalks along the York Road frontage in an amount to be determined by the township engineer and township solicitor, that the applicant would be granted a waiver from the parking lot landscape requirements, a partial waiver subject to final landscape planting design to be approved by the township engineer. And the applicant would be granted waivers from the illuminance requirements to exceed the 0.2-foot candle limit by up to to go up to a maximum of 1.0-foot candles as depicted in Sheet 9 of the plans, subject to the compliance with the requirements of Section 524.4F of the SALDO, and further subject to the applicant's agreement to address any and all complaints regarding the illumination to the satisfaction of the township engineer. Such other terms and conditions as to be set forth on an action letter to be issued by the township solicitor's office in accordance with the MPC.
Okay, is there a motion?
Motion.
Mr. Monroe, is there a second?
Second.
Ms. Frescatore, is there any further comment from the board?
Yeah, I mean, it's for a long time we've been looking at that property and wishing someone would come along and redevelop it. And Lidl has come along and redeveloped it, not only redeveloped it, but a more modern design than what we're accustomed to. I mean, you know, I'm one of the biggest proponents of redevelopment in the town, and one thing we've been looking to get more of is diversity in our offerings, and especially in our architecture. So Lidl is leading the forefront there. Mr. Lewis does bring up a very valid concern in my eyes with the road design. It's not going to be enough for me to withhold my approval, but I do caution that. I mean, I use that. The adjacent SMG Sportsplex Plaza, dry cleaners, pizza, all that, I find the same problems. The reason I haven't been using the light is because it's been blocked off for all this time. And my concern not so much is the car, it's more of that people are going to try flying through your parking lot and somebody's going to get hit. I mean, I would just ask that we be mindful of that moving forward and be, you know, I'm sure that the last thing they want is that situation too. And we'll see how it plays out. But all in all, I am thankful that that Lidl is choosing Warminster and bringing with it 30 to 35 jobs and a modern design and sprucing up that corner. And to the point where we're concerned about possible future development on the site, which I completely understand the concerns that were addressed, I do believe that the board at that time, whoever that may be, could be years down the road, and Lidl itself, I would hope, would not want to demean the site by then putting on something that draws away from the beauty of the adjoining sites with the Lidl development and the redevelopment of the site next to it. So, all in all, I thank you for choosing Warminster, and welcome.
I agree with everything Mr. Crawley just said. Thank you,
Jason.
You
can call me Jason. It's okay.
And I do as well. I want to thank you for coming to town. I know you guys drilled down and did your due diligence and worked with the staff to get the review letters and everything compressed before you came to see us. And we really appreciate it. Thanks for coming to town.
Can I add?
Professionals have been great. I didn't mean to interrupt, but.
No, tell us how we're great. It's okay. I just wanted to point out that all of our professional staff and the boards involved have really worked with lightning speed on this. This application came in July, and here we are 4 months later on a significant project about to give the approval. So thanks to everyone involved for doing this.
Yeah, we zip through the letter, everything's a will comply. They don't realize that we've gone through, you know, several formal reviews, and that's why they're asked for a preliminary final. I know that in the past that's been an issue, and the reason we do support that is because we had a good relationship working through the design. When it's, there's give and take at staff level, it works really well. And this is, again, we did another review real quick in the last month here to get it down to where there are no significant issues. They've already met with PennDOT, and you know, it's ready to go. So it's nice to have that working relationship over the last couple months.
Okay. Is there any other comment from the public before the board takes action? Seeing none, I'm going to call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Motion carries.
Thank you again.
Thank you. I look forward to seeing you guys open for business. Give these guys a second. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
You too.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good luck.
Thank you very much.
Make sure you have plenty of samples for Mark.
Absolutely. Oh, you want these? Do you need these?
Yes,
there's a whole extras. Bunch. Yeah.
Yes,
thank you. Oh, yeah. Okay. To be recycled.
Okay, while you guys get set up, I'm going to move to item B. Review land development 16-06, Warminster Express, preliminary and final land development approval. Mr. Savona.
Mr. Chairman, the next application for this evening is the application, as you indicated, for 16-06 Warminster Express for the redevelopment of the site known as 440 West Street Road. This is a 1.67-acre site located within the C2 commercial zoning district. The current use of the site is a Use 38 motor vehicle fueling station. As you may know, the BP gas station, which has a car wash. The existing site features include two buildings, gas pumps, associated parking areas, driveways, and a stormwater management basin. The application proposes a Use 39 car wash, which is permitted in the C2 district. The proposed improvements include the removal of the existing gas station building and pump canopy, construction of two additions to the existing car wash building, and the construction of a cashier's canopy. The building additions will total 1,534 square feet. Total proposed building coverage would be 4,003 square feet. There will be some additional site improvements, including parking areas, driveways, and a stormwater management facility. The applicant on the application is 440 West Street Road, Inc., doing business as Warminster Express. And the applicant is present this evening, represented by?
By Matt Chartrand from Bowler Engineering.
Matt, welcome. Are you prepared to proceed?
I am. And I guess as a matter of business, I also do have copies of our waiver request letter, which was distributed. I'm not sure if you have.
This is the November 15th.
November 15th revised. Okay. Great.
Why don't you give us an overview of the plan and what you're proposing on the site plan, and then we can address the waivers.
Sure. This existing facility is at 440 West Street Road. I have a plan here in front of you. Hopefully you can see that. I apologize. It's not in color. Maybe it's not as easy to see from far away. But it's approximately 1.38 acre property on the southern side of Street Road, which if you're looking at the plan is across the top portion of the plan. We are bordered to the south side by Olive Street, which is a largely residential area. The existing site right now has a car wash. It also has a gas facility on it that was mentioned earlier. As part of this redevelopment plan, Warminster Express is looking at basically removing that gas component from the existing site and expanding the car wash. So that's really the driving force behind the redevelopment of that area.
Okay.
I'll show. I do have an aerial plan that shows the location here. So shows the existing facility, the gas pumps out there, and then the existing site circulation that's there. So the proposal, apologize. The proposal, as I noted, would be to remove the gas pumps, which are located roughly in that central portion of the site, install some parking spaces there, which would be used for vacuuming vehicles, not parking that's needed for this type of use. As I'm sure you can imagine, we don't need parking spaces other than for that, the vacuuming. What we would propose to do is maintain the existing driveways where they are. They're fully functional, and keep sort of a one-way circulation as you would enter from Street Road, come to the back of the site, enter the what would be the expanded
area of the car wash, slight expansion on the rear about 43 feet, and then an expansion on the front of about an additional 12 feet there, get a longer tunnel. It's going to have new equipment in it, be much more efficient in terms of its water usage, things like that. And again, I think overall would be an improvement on what's there right now. We have, again, received review letters from your consultants. We've issued a response in terms of the waivers that we are requesting. And aside from those waivers, we will comply with all other items in the review letters.
Do you have any other copies of your November 15th waiver request?
I do.
That's what I was asking for, because I can't seem to find it.
Sure.
A little confusing. The date is actually October 21, but then it says revised November 15th. So.
No, I've got it. I must.
We have it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's right. I have it on the computer. Yes, thank you.
So before we go to the waivers, any general questions from the board with respect to the site plan or the project in general?
What are the hours of operation for
The expected hours of operation would be either 8 to 8 or 8 to 9. You know, no reason to really run later than that for this type of
Is this going to be automated, so similar to the other new ones we've seen pop up in the area? Is this going to be automated as well?
Well, yeah.
Oh, there you go. Beautiful.
Have representatives here, the owners of this facility. This is a proposed rendering of generally what it would look like. We understand signage is something that we'd have to come back to the township for, but it's just sort of a rendering. But hopefully, again, much cleaner look, sleeker building, be a much improved look to that particular location.
You will have an employee on site, though, right? Even though it's automated, so to speak, you'll have someone there monitoring the facility.
Yeah, in case we get stuck in there.
And we've got two parking spaces, and that's part of one of the waivers that we're requesting is in regard to the length of those spaces, but we've got two spaces at the back that would be for employees, and then again, all those vacuum spaces up at the front would be for customers.
The only question I have, I mean, it's actually one of the waivers. You want me to just wait until we get to the waivers?
Sure.
Okay, I'll hold off.
All right. If there's no other sort of big picture.
Yeah, we can drill down on
fine
comments after you do the waivers.
Then we'll get to the waivers that you've requested in your February 15th letter. As I understand it, Matt, you're going to comply with all of the other engineering review, zoning officer review, fire marshal review, county planning commission, and planning reviews?
That's correct.
Okay. So the first waiver you're requesting is section 301.2 to allow a preliminary final approval. Mr. Kennard, any issues
no
with
objection
the plan?
No.
The next is section 406.3B to provide existing features within 400 feet. Again, you'll do whatever's requested by the township engineer?
Correct. Yeah, we would include an aerial photograph as part of our plan set if that would, satisfy that particular.
We'll let you
comment.
Work that out with Mr. Kennard.
Sure.
The next is a waiver from 511.7B to permit a drive-through lane length of approximately 520 feet and stacking for 23 vehicles in lieu of the maximum 10 stacking spaces, which is permitted. You want to explain why the deviation?
Sure. Again, I'll try to use a pointer here so I can stand closer to the mic. A significant portion of that really has to do with the alignment as you're coming into the back of the building. So as I mentioned before, we're extending from what is the existing back of building back around 43 feet. So with that, we've got to have the turning radius necessary to get the vehicles in there, which aligns, a little bit further back on our site. Right now, say that driveway coming to the existing drive-through is somewhere in the middle of where our stormwater basin is going to be. So that pushes that driveway back a little further than what we have right now, and then coming around to the other side of the site where the parking is, that's sort of where we end up. It's not that we necessarily need 23, vehicle stacking there, and that, that there would be an expectation. Obviously, we want to make sure that there's more than enough. We want to make sure that there's not going to be an impact out to street road of people blocking this up, but we don't have that expectation. It's really, again, just sort of where it aligns.
Mr. Cutter, any issue?
No objection. I'd rather have them stacking on the site than out on street road, and it's
Thank
a
you.
Function. Pretty simple waiver function of the layout design, but I support it.
Next is a waiver from 511.9 to permit a drive-through canopy height of 16 foot 4 inches in lieu of the maximum 15 feet. Any issues with that, Mr. Kenner?
None.
Section 511.10, do not provide a traffic impact study for the drive-through. Any issues with that, Mr. Kenner?
No.
Section 512.2, to allow for 18 foot stall depth within an angled space in lieu of the required minimum 20 foot depth. Is there any issue with that configuration?
No, and that was for what, two spaces? Or
correct.
There's only two of the spaces.
The two angled spaces that are at the rear. And there's actually room there for the vehicles to overhang the curb if they needed to. We just didn't want to put more paving out there than what we needed.
Next is a waiver from 523.4 to not provide street trees along either Street Road or Olive Street. I assume that's because you've got traffic exiting on and off.
Yeah, we do. We obviously have some wide driveways there, entrance and exit, but we've also got a overhead utility lines that run directly along Street Road that would impede us from being able to put additional trees along that portion. I do have a copy of our landscape plan. I'll show you. Which again, hopefully exhibits, you can see here the circular, larger circles are large trees that we're proposing on the site. The smaller circles in here being, you know, bushes and other shrubs that we're trying to fill in as much area as we can. And again, I think one of the additional waivers that we're asking for is in regard to more planting within the stormwater management basin that we really can't even fit because it's just not going to survive, according to, you know, our landscape architect who's worked out this plan.
So how many trees? So there's going to be no trees separating the property from Olive?
No, not from Olive Street. Olive Street has an existing row of white pines, double row of white pines along that. We are actually going to be filling that in with more plantings along the Olive Street portion. It's street trees in addition to the buffering along Olive Street, that's what we're asking for, and then the street trees along Street Road. We're not asking for relief on the buffering to Olive Street. That's provided. There are existing trees that are out there today, some pretty substantial trees that are out there today. There's a couple gaps within that, the double row of white pines, which we've agreed that we'll fill those in to try to, you know, completely buffer Olive Street as much as we can.
Yeah, I must say, this is my, I guess you can call it a gripe. When we go through property redevelopments, one of the benefits of going through property redevelopments with some of the new ordinance and whatnot is, you know, a beautification.
Sure.
And it's, I guess, if there's any way that we can squeeze something out with that frontage along Street Road, I would be very appreciative.
Okay, and again, we do have shrubs and bushes along that portion in there in the area that's beyond. You've got sidewalk that runs along Street Road that's existing. We've got some plantings that are going to be put in there. What we don't want to do, and what we're not able to do, is put tall trees that are going to impact with the overhead wires and everything else. So I believe that we're doing as much as we can with this site. You know, if you look around it again at the other areas that we've got, we are supplementing in the rear, like I said, along Olive Street. I believe that it's been, you know, reviewed by the township engineer from that aspect. And again, in our discussion with the Planning Commission, it was a similar sentiment, but there was a feeling that with this type of a site, with what we're doing, it was, you know, kind of the best that we could do.
Well, what did the Planning Commission recommend?
They supported that waiver.
Yeah, they supported it. In fact, you both touched on, Mr. McPhillips, the buffer in the back is required by actually the Zoning Hearing Board. So it can't even be a waivable thing, the double row. They're going to supplement. Your subdivision land development ordinance requires buffering. So between the Zoning Hearing Board condition and your buffering, Olive Street will be filled in, whatever's not there, and they have to comply with the zoning conditions. And I believe there's also a fence.
There's a fence.
That's so that
true.
Wasn't mentioned either. So there'll be a fence along Olive Street, or between the, I guess I should write along your curb line.
Right.
Is it a privacy fence?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So you'll have that, then you'll have landscaping, then Olive Street, and then the residence. So I think that was missed earlier on.
Okay.
And then, Mr. Monroe, to your point out front, the planner, myself, we got green thumbs. There's nowhere to put.
Even ornamental trees?
Well, I was going to say I could ask for them to look at maybe something smaller ornamental, but and they're nodding their head. So we can make that a partial waiver subject to my approval.
It's nicer than shrubs.
Yeah, we can. Maybe they can. Yeah, I heard you.
Yeah, we don't get too many opportunities with specific properties.
We have to weigh the street trees. I can't.
No, I understand that.
But maybe in lieu of, we'll do try to do some shrubs or additional shrubs or ornamental trees. So that could be a condition.
Anything would be appreciated.
Understood.
So if we do it as a partial waiver subject to, I would suggest the following two conditions. One, that the applicant do plantings along street road as recommended and required by the township engineer. And secondly, that the applicant would be granted the waiver as applies to Olive Street of the street trees, subject to maintaining and completing the buffer that's in existence to the satisfaction of the township engineer. Any issue with those conditions?
No issue.
Okay. The next is section 523.5C to permit buffer landscaping as proposed on the plan. I think we've covered the wraparound waiver.
Yep.
523.7 to provide 5 trees, 8 flowering ornamental trees, and 89 shrubs within the proposed basin. That would be the required level of planting?
That's less than what's required. I think we list just below that, the required being 22 trees.
44 and 220.
Ornamental and 220.
We would support the waiver subject to how it's laid out on the preliminary plans. Because of the stacking area, the actual design is more of a, unfortunately, it's a deep basin kind of bowl shape versus your standard conventional landscape berms and all that. So there's just not enough room to plant all the landscaping within the basin.
So again, I would recommend the condition be subject to the approval of the township engineer.
Okay.
Next is a waiver from 523.8 to permit a fee in lieu of providing replacement trees for the existing trees to be removed. Mr. Canada, any issue with calculating it as a fee in lieu?
No, and there's no other room other than we'll look at the ornamental or trees or shrubs out front, but the remainder would be a fee in lieu of tree replacement, which is in keeping with all other approvals.
Next, you're asking for a waiver from 524.5G to permit 2.5 foot candles at the street road ultimate right of way in lieu of the maximum 0.5, and to permit 0.6 foot candles at the western property in lieu of the maximum 0.2.
Correct.
Yeah, can you just,
sure,
because you heard the discussion.
Affect residents on Olive Street at all?
No. Okay. No, but I want him to explain just so you hear that.
Great, thank you.
Yeah. So what we're talking about here, where you see my pointer pointing, that's the ultimate right of way line along street road. So we do have lighting within the landscape area here to be able to light the driveways, make sure that they're safe. What we're asking for, basically it says, you know, we've got to be at 0.5 foot candles at the ultimate right of way line, which is pretty significantly significantly back into our property as opposed to where the curb line is. Where we are hitting the actual curb line, we are at the I'm sorry, I just wanted to read what we had noted below. So we're at that half a foot candle where we get to the curb line of street road. But again, I think from a safety perspective with a commercial property like this, that's really where we would need to be, is have that half foot candle about 15 feet further out into that driveway. The 0.6 foot candles that we're talking about is along the side property line. Again, we have a pretty narrow space there between where the driveway is and where our lighting needs to be. We are going to try to shield that as much as possible, but there is still going to be some spillover. I think similar to the application that you guys just had before you, this is another commercial property. Probably not an area that we really want to have a dark spot between or fully close it off. We think that this is, 0.6 versus 0.2 in that area would be the minimum that we could really achieve.
If we have any complaints, then
yeah, we can have the same conditions before.
But at Olive Street, we are not proposing any bleed over into that area of our of our light.
Thank you.
Mr.
Next, stormwater ordinance waiver from section 425.3H6C to reduce the required freeboard within the emergency spillway to 6 inches. That's a technical waiver.
Yes,
any
issues? No issues.
And next is from the requirements of 602.3C to permit the removal of trees over 24 inches. Where are you removing trees and how many?
So there are a few that are back towards the southwest corner of the property and the southeast corner of the property that exceed the 24 inches. That's actually something that we had not noted previously, and I don't think it was in the original review letter, but it was caught at the Planning Commission meeting when we were here,
right,
as we were talking through some of those items, that there are some larger trees there.
So
we're
going to
do our best.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry. There's probably about four or five of those size trees that we're talking about. We're going to do our best to try to save them at the entrance portion here, to see if there's any way that we can redesign. But unfortunately, even with disturbing the roots of a tree that big, it's not likely to survive. So we are, in this case, going to ask for the waiver on that.
So why don't we do actually a partial waiver for you to try, you know, part of the redesign and part of the final design, wrapping it up before you record the plans. If you can save a couple of them, that's fine. And then I think Mr. Savone was ready to say, typically you would do a fee in lieu of then whatever you can't save, just like the tree replacement. So normally I'd ask you to replant on site, but you don't have any other room to, right, to plant those. So
okay.
All right. And lastly is section 800 from required improvements. I assume this is the streets or the sidewalks, curbs, et cetera.
Correct. And again, that was brought up at the Planning Commission level, that, you know, this is a site that has existing sidewalks, existing curbs.
And so in actuality, I think you actually comply with okay, the intent of the ordinance. The actual design, no, but there's existing sidewalk, curb, and all that out. There's not any other room for improvements out at this site. So
since there are existing sidewalks, there's also no need for a fee.
No, I would not. That's why I said that. There would not be a fee.
Any other waivers, Matt?
No.
All right.
Before you craft a motion, I'm just going to open it up for any more discussion from the board.
So the gas station that's currently there, there will be all precautions for safety to cap those off, correct?
Oh, environmental, you mean? For the
environmental, yes.
Yeah,
they'll have to decommission the pumps and tanks and everything.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Oh, there's like environmental studies.
I was going to say, I don't actually get too involved in that part. There's strict requirements on that. And they'll have to file. I'm sure they're aware of it and already done their due diligence.
Yeah.
The environmental reporting,
DEP protocols. And
yep. Okay. Thank you.
That's handled at the state level.
Is there any input from the public? Sure. Come on.
John Briovos, 674 Joseph Avenue, Warminster, Pennsylvania. Just as a note, she brought up a key question. Of course, I've been around here forever, but I know that property or that site had been a contaminated site at one time from, we had a fuel leak there. Mm-hmm. So once they do dig it up, we want to make sure, I guess the state DEP is going to get involved in it, correct?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they'll come down, make sure, I would think that maybe somebody here would also take another look at it once they have the ground opened up, that they got everything the last time that they did open it up, because we did have a nice size fuel leak on that property. I think this project for him is a go. It's a good one. Since Wawa opened up, the fuel sales died. He's probably got the best car wash right now in the township. I send people there in the course of my dealings. But with a new setup, it would even be better for him. I think the other thing would be the lengthening of the back of the driveway getting in. It's very difficult to get in there. I know you're going to move further back into the property, but with the trees and the fence, I think he should be okay. That's my opinion. Okay?
No, great. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Hey, I'm going to ask Mr. Savona to craft a motion.
Certainly. Mr. Chairman, if the board's inclined, a motion would be in order to grant preliminary and final land development approval for the application of 440 West Street Road, Inc., for redevelopment of the property identified as 440 West Street Road, tax map parcel 49-19-235, subject to the applicant's compliance with all of the recommended terms and conditions contained in the review letters of the Township Engineer, the Township Zoning Officer, the Township Fire Marshal, the Bucks County Planning Commission, and the Township Planner, subject to the following waivers and conditions as contained in the applicant's November 15th, 2016 waiver request letter, with those waivers being predicated on the following specific conditions: that the applicant will be providing such existing features as required by the Township Engineer, that the applicant will be granted a partial waiver from the street tree requirements, subject to the applicant providing such plantings as may be required by the Township Engineer along Street Road, and subject to the applicant complying with the maintenance of the buffer along the Olive Street frontage and the completion of that buffer as indicated on the plans. And the applicant will provide such basin plantings as depicted in the plans and to the satisfaction of the Township Engineer. That the applicant will be permitted to pay a fee in lieu of providing replacement trees to be determined by the Township Engineer. That the applicant will be granted a waiver from the illumination requirements of Section 524.5G, subject to the applicant's addressing any complaints regarding off-site lighting to the satisfaction of the Township Engineer. The applicant will be granted a partial waiver to permit the removal of trees over 24 inches, subject to the payment of a fee in lieu of any trees not replaced as determined by the Township Engineer. In addition, the applicant will comply with all of the terms, conditions, and provisions to be set forth in the approval letter to be issued by the Office of the Township Solicitor in accordance with the Municipality's Planning Code.
Okay. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Mr. Crowe, is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Monroe, is there any further comment from the board?
I would just like to say to the owners, thanks for staying in town instead of just closing up shop and then having another vacant lot waiting to be sold. You guys looked and saw, you know, I know about the car wash here, but I never even thought about expanding it to just a car wash. I live in that neighborhood. I'm excited to see it when it's open, a nice new building. But most of all, I thank you for sticking with us and staying in town instead of just pulling up stakes and selling the lot and letting it sit. So I appreciate that very much. Our business community is getting stronger all the time, and you guys are a big part of it, and I thank you.
I always want to say I'm very satisfied with you wanting to protect the residents as far as the lighting and the privacy fence and the environmental issue and the tree issue. Thanks for, you know, working together with our staff, and our thanks to the staff for putting all of this together, and we welcome you. Thank you.
I thank you as well. You're going to save me a trip all the way down to 611 on Sundays now. So thank you very much. It's an excellent redevelopment of the property.
That's true. They got preliminary final plan.
Is there any other comments from the public? The board takes action. Is there any other from the board? Okay, I'm going to call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Motion carries.
Thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. I look forward to you guys getting it redeveloped.
And that has been coordinated.
Okay, the next up is item C. Review land development 16/11, Sands Loan 2 lot subdivision, preliminary and final land development approval. Mr. Savona.
Mr. Chairman, this is an application for approval of a minor subdivision for the property located at 133 and 135 Evergreen Avenue, tax parcels 49-18-148-2 and 49-18-148-3. The applicant was recommended for preliminary and final approval by the Township's Planning Commission. The plan has been reviewed by the Township Engineer, the Township Zoning Officer, the Fire Marshal, the Bucks County Planning Commission, and the Township Planner. I don't see anyone here from Mr. Shadrow's office or from the applicant. Is anyone here for this application?
Don't look it.
Be nice to see something.
Yeah. Should we table this until the applicant's present?
Yeah. Okay. I think that's probably appropriate.
I agree.
At this point.
There's a couple comments. I mean, I think we work it all out, but they need to.
Well, I think we should
notified that we're having a. Did we know it's there?
Letters, yeah.
Planning Commission, they got approval, preliminary final recommendation, Planning Commission, a 3-0 vote. Usually Amanda's there, and Judy and Karen, they communicate.
Yeah, let's table this.
I agree.
I was going to say, isn't there, I mean, with developments like this, or redevelopments like this, in these kind of neighborhoods, there's usually issues with neighbors. Has there been
any? Yeah, that's also I'm concerned about. I mean, they're just subdivision or land development, but usually have a neighbor or two. Or,
right.
It went smooth at Planning Commission, but you shouldn't take action.
I'm going to move the table.
Well, just with one caveat. The application was filed with the township on August the 31st, 2016. If you don't mind, I would recommend, we don't have a verification that the applicant has signed a waiver of the 90 days. So my recommendation would be that the board make a motion to table the application, provided that the applicant provides a waiver of the 90 days, or in the alternative, to authorize my office to deny the plan for failure to comply with the required conditions of the recommendation.
Good advice, Mr. Savona. Thank you.
Is there a motion?
Motion.
Second.
A second.
Mr. McPhillips, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
The chair votes aye.
Judy did report that they have a waiver, but I don't see a document in there confirming that.
We'll have to reach out to them.
Well, it'll be relisted or they'll reapply.
Okay, that's fine. All right, professionals reports. Township manager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have my written report in case there's any questions. A few things that I'll report on. We've had a good meeting with the YMCA, kicking off the next phase of our discussions with them. They, of course, are in the process of opening up their storefront, and they're selling their memberships right now. So if anyone has a chance to stop by, please do so. They've updated their website, and hopefully the community can go ahead and support them. Our next steps is the new site analysis will be done by YMCA. A feasibility study will be done by YMCA. And we'll be looking at the membership numbers and regrouping early next year to see where we are with the numbers, and then have a presentation or an update to you from them. Also working on an agreement with our ambulance corps. I've talked about this a few times through the budget process. We are giving them some additional funding because they've been struggling, like all ambulance companies have, with some of the new regulations and laws that have come out. The Comprehensive Plan Subcommittee will have their organizational kickoff meeting on December 6th, so we all look forward to that. I already mentioned the draft of the road improvement plan. We anticipate in December, presented to you in January. And finally, I'd like to thank all the firefighters that came out for the recent fire we had at Jefferson at the Creek, Jefferson on the Creek. We did have one officer who was suffered smoke inhalation. She was treated and released, and I understand that she'll be back to duty shortly. So obviously our thoughts with her and everyone else that responded. That's all I have to report this evening.
Anyone have anything for Mr. Schuster? Okay. We're going to move along to the solicitor's report. Mr. Savona.
Just a few items, Mr. Chairman. Again, you have my November 14th report. A few things to highlight that will be coming up on future agendas or will take place before the end of the year. Under the litigation issues, as the board knows, we have a pending land use appeal relating to the 2009 rezoning of property at Street Road in Davisville. In order to settle that, we have agreed to process a request by the applicant to rezone that property from residential to back to commercial, which was its zoning classification from approximately 1973 through 2009. That ordinance is advertised and will be on your agenda for December the 15th. Assuming the board agrees to the rezoning, the applicant would discontinue that appeal. As Mr. Schuster indicated earlier, we have finally received the final draft codification from General Code. We've had the opportunity to review that document. You've authorized this evening the advertisement of that ordinance for final adoption. Because the codification contains the entire mass of laws that have been approved by the Board of Supervisors, that also includes the subdivision and land development ordinance and the zoning ordinance, as a precaution and to eliminate any issues with procedural irregularities that may arise, because our courts have essentially made us responsible for any defects at any point ever. Whenever we have the opportunity to codify, we send the saldo and the zoning portions through the MPC process, which means we send it to the County Planning Commission, to the Local Planning Commission. It's pro forma. We haven't changed anything, but it's designed to close any procedural irregularities that may have ever happened. So we will start the ordinance on that process with a goal toward having a hearing to finally approve the codification in either January or February of next year. The Warminster Swim Club, as Mr. Schuster indicated, I have listed on the agenda this evening a resolution 2016-48,
which I'm asking the board approve this evening. This resolution simply authorizes, it's a requirement of the title company, it authorizes on behalf of the board and the township that the proper officers of the municipality be authorized to execute whatever documents are necessary at closing to complete that transaction. At the moment, the closing, it looks like we've scheduled it for November the 30th, so we can get it done before the end of the year. So I would ask that the board approve a motion to approve resolution number 2016-48, which would authorize the appropriate officers, the township manager or the township assistant manager, to execute whatever documents are necessary to complete that closing.
Okay, so anyone have anything for Mr. Savona?
Do we have to vote on this resolution?
I need a motion to approve that resolution.
Okay,
yes.
All right.
I'll make that motion.
All right. Is there a second? Mr. McPhillips? Okay. All in favor?
Aye. Thank you, Mr. Savona. Aye.
Chairman votes aye.
And that's all, Mr. Chairman. I don't have anything further if you have questions. Otherwise, I'm done.
Okay. That's it for Mr. Savona. We'll move on to the engineer's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You have our November engineer's report. As far as updates for new projects, I only have two. Usually I have three or four, but we have two projects. I'm not sure you'll see them for quite some time. They have to go through, you may have one, the conditional use application 300 Jacksonville Road. It's a proposed transit-oriented development for 24 townhomes. That actually is and maybe Mike can jump in. I'm not sure if he wants to talk about it too much, but it's not your typical transit-oriented development. It'll be for to serve handicapped individuals, and there's a whole process for that. And I believe the conditional use is scheduled for
December 15th.
So it will not be going, and it's going to plan, scheduled to go to Planning Commission November 22nd for recommendation. So you will see that. And then another sketch plan, or a sketch plan for Davisville Road for proposed 29 townhomes. It's actually the way it's submitted was a proposed zoning amendment. They haven't officially filed for that. Submitted a sketch plan. They're proposing R4 zoning in R1 district. Staff already talked about it. The letter wasn't very favorable. I doubt you will see that.
Where on Davisville Road?
I don't have the address.
It's up by Street Road where the factory is.
Yeah, it was. Yes, it is close to Street Road, but I don't have the address.
5-acre parcel?
Actually, it's only 4.7 acres. We had they came in and met with staff. Maybe it was Greg's first week here, a couple weeks into it. We said, yeah, that's not going to work and for apartments, and then they came in with 29 townhomes and a rezoning. So
keep going.
Yeah. So
big mansions, they can stop.
Staff had discussed it before our letters went out, and I think they probably got the message. So those are the only two applications that came in. I will let you know that although Ann's Choice Phase 2, the redeveloped or amended final, was approved by the board in September, September 15th, just shows you how it takes a few months. We just got the cleanup plans or check set plans in. I assume they're not going to try to start construction until the spring. At this rate, they want the plans recorded and permits pulled. Home Two Suites is moving very quickly. They like to go. I don't know if they'll be ready before winter, but they have resubmitted there. They're calling every few days. And just a quick update, we had some big projects over the last couple months. Leary, Longstreth, and the Tall Oaks developments all received approval. From what I'm hearing, they're all going to want to gear up in the spring. So I get asked a lot, are they going to start? They're going to start. So we're running out of time before winter sets in. So probably going out on a limb a little bit, but saying they're not going to start any type of construction until the spring on those three large projects. And that's all I have.
I have a couple of questions. How are things going over at Little Lane? I haven't heard.
Yeah, actually, I was going to say no news is good news, but I talked to the fire marshal and for my staff and Amanda and Eric Hines. Things have gotten a lot better. We all, Greg has any updates, but it was tough there for a while. We knew it was a lot going on in a short amount of time. So I think the township, everybody handled it as best we could.
The developers worked to secure the property. I understand there was a lot of people wanting.
Yeah, there's a lot going on, security issues. We're still trying to work on the other project that's a lot going on is a station at Bucks East, the Petrucci project over in Jacksonville. Joe Velt and I talked tonight before the meeting. We still have some minor issues with fire access and whatnot, so we'll try to work through that. But they've always been cooperative. But there's a lot going on. They're moving quick, too.
The train station's moving along pretty good, too, the second action.
Yes. No issues. They move quick. Once they get approval, they go. They get their permits.
this is a little naive of me, but I mean, when they're doing these types of projects, building these homes, do they continue that through the winter too, or is that, do they stop because of?
Yeah, they'll go until you hit, you know.
They do it all? Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I've.
Normally, the ones that have the foundations in and poured and everything, they continue on with.
If they can get the concrete. If they can get the concrete work done, then it's just framing, and they'll frame as long as they can.
That's what I enjoyed about the drywall business. It has to be above 55 degrees for us to work, so it doesn't.
Okay, I see.
Takes, I'll be honest with you, it takes a couple feet of snow to stop everybody.
Right, okay. Correct.
A couple feet. I noticed the builders put the houses up for sale at different samples.
Yeah, I saw something
website.
Online there. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep. So. Be here before you know.
The good thing is people won't be moving in during the winter. That's where it gets tough on staff. You can't, you know, pave. You can't put concrete stoops in the sidewalk. So you will have some, not typically in townhouse, but in single family homes. They try to say, can we move somebody in? They sold their house, and you can't pour concrete. You can't pave. And you have to work through some temporary conditions to get people in. But the good thing is that we won't have that issue on any of these jobs.
Any word on the Dunkin' Donuts in Norristown and County Line?
No.
No?
Can I give you an update?
We literally have had no reply. I've talked with Steve Harris, who represented the applicant. I think the last time I heard from Steve was 3 or 4 months ago. They're significantly overdrawn in their escrow. We talked about it at the last legal and engineering meeting. My office is going to lean that against the property because we have simply had zero input back from them. They've gone completely quiet.
I'm getting a lot of complaints about the site, and when's the last time it was cleaned up? Do we know?
I don't know. Every time we get the complaint, we forward off to L&I, and they usually get some kind of a response. But if you get the complaints again, let me know. But I'll have L&I check on it again.
It's something I think we really need to keep on top of.
That
it's
would all be under
at this point where we.
How about Chick-fil-A? I'm here on January 1st. I mean, how's the progress?
That's news to me.
You guys are on site. How's it going?
Yeah, it's going great, actually. You know, they have their own standards, and there's some tweaks here and there. And we're trying to work with them. I mean, given the size of that project overall, but Chick-fil-A has their way of doing things. And I heard some rumblings, but my staff's trying to work with them. Mm-hmm. So, everything's been good. I mean, outside of the hiccup with Hart School and which the board heard about, it was a quiet few weeks.
What about the Holy Redeemer Medical Building? Across from Home Two Suites.
Yeah, that got quiet for a while because they were just doing the building. And
yeah, I think
and
the core work's done and the fit out.
Yeah,
works.
So actually,
so
yeah.
Getting phone calls.
Yeah, they're trying to get that wrapped up. So
yeah, it's looking real close.
Yeah, yeah, there's a lot of activity. Again, they're great to work with. Good contractor.
Yeah, I watch construction over the last couple months because of being at the daycare all the time. But
it's a nice looking building.
It's a nice, very nice building.
MRA Group and the contractor, Northstar Work, I think it's Northstar, work real close together. In other townships, so they know how to do things, and they've been very cooperative. So we've been very fortunate lately on that.
I guess the only other question, has there been any movement on the great tree debate between Franklin and Ann's Choice?
Yeah, I ask about it constantly.
Because depending on who you talk to, the other one's responsible.
Amanda has been trying to trace that down. Okay. And she's been in contact.
I usually don't say this. I'm not involved. I barely pull that card. But
board member recommended to me to give Steve Harris's office a phone call.
She was supposed to give them a call. Involved, I'll double check back.
It's the condo board. They're common elements, so we've got to go after the condo association.
All right, cool. That's all I had, Mr. Chairman.
All right, so we're going to move on to the Township Manager announcement of upcoming agenda items. Mr. Schuster.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Unless there's any objection, I will cancel the December 1st meeting. The next meeting would be December 15th. At that meeting, you can anticipate the Township Planner, Judy Goldstein, here to give the results of the facility study report that she's been working on. Also at that meeting, on your agenda will be the adoption of the budget, which you authorized this evening for advertisement, along with the setting of the tax rates. We are planning to update the fee schedule. That's something that's typically done at the beginning of the year. However, we're going to make some proposed changes to that. Nothing drastic, but more in line with the ordinances that authorize those fees. They've gotten a little bit out of whack, so to say, and update the fees to be competitive and with our surrounding neighbors. So we'd like to give that presentation at the next meeting at the 15th. You wouldn't take action, but you have an opportunity to ask questions and learn a little bit about it before taking action in January. And the last thing I had, you've already discussed, is the conditional use hearing for 300 Jacksonville.
Okay. Any reason why we're canceling the meeting, first meeting in December?
I don't really have anything other than what I just discussed. Yeah. There's no land developments other than the Sansalon now, I guess, but they can go on the 15th, and that's a minor subdivision, certainly nothing time sensitive. So it's at your discretion. If you'd like to hold that meeting, you certainly could.
Well, what I would think is time sensitive is adopting the budget. Are we still going to have enough time to adopt the budget?
You can't do it on the 1st. We have to post it for 20 days, and we have to do it on the 15th in order to meet the requirement.
Okay, so.
All right, that's fine. Is that it, Mr. Schuster?
That is all I have, Mr. Chairman.
We'll go for the next round of public comment. Is there any public comment? Okay, seeing none, I'm going to move to supervisors' comments. Ms. Frescatore?
Yes, please indulge me, fellow supervisors, Mr. Chair. Since the recent presidential election, we have seen discriminatory incidents around the country in our schools and communities. It is in our own community now and our schools. Warminster has always had a reputation for mutual respect between our Democratic and Republican residents. Our township represents the true meaning of America's melting pot, with the diversity of race, religion, ethnicity, and gender. I feel very disheartened and sad by the many phone calls from residents expressing fear for their children due to the recent hateful and racist incidents in our schools. For our children's sake, as well as our own, we must teach our children through acts of kindness and tolerance towards our fellow neighbors with differing opinions. Our local leaders, teachers, parents, and grandparents must lead by example, teaching our children that even though we may not agree with each other, we will respect each other. Now is the time for us to stand together with one voice and declare that racism, hatred, and bigotry will not be tolerated in our community and schools. And happy Thanksgiving to all our families out there. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Deb. Mr. Monroe.
Well, I would second that, and happy Thanksgiving. I'm shocked it's here already. So.
Yeah, me too. Mr. McPhillips.
Yeah, just the last night, the Greater Bucksmont Chamber of Commerce had an event at the Warminster VFW. And they had Commissioner Rob Lockery gave a State of the County update. And it was a great event, well attended. And I guess being on the Board of Directors for the Chamber of Commerce, they asked me to introduce Commissioner Lockery at the event, which was really nice. But which I really liked was the idea was Commissioner Lockery talked about the proposed county budget for 2017 and how it will not include a tax increase. So here in Warminster, you will not see a tax increase in your local taxes as well as your county taxes, and that's something very to be grateful. So,
wonderful Christmas present.
It was very much so.
The event was very well run. My hat's off to the chamber and their planning commission, which included Mr. McPhillips. A lot of our local businesses were in attendance and actually participated and donated food to the event and everything. And, you know, Tony Luke's, Santucci's, Mike's York Street Bar and Grill, Steam Pub, they all came out, and we appreciate everybody supporting not just economic development here in Warminster, but in Bucks County. If the county's strong, Warminster will be strong too. So we appreciated everybody participating. And I would just like to say to everyone, have a happy Thanksgiving. If you're traveling this holiday season, please be safe on those roads out there. And we'll see you in December.
Awesome. I just have a few things. I want to commend our land development team. I really think we have things working well now. It's showing every month we have land developments coming in. The applicants, other than the one that show up tonight, but the applicants are prepared. Their review letters are condensed because they've worked with the staff. I really think we have a nice apparatus in place, and it's due to you guys. You guys work along with Judy and Greg and Amanda and the entire staff.
Thank you.
And I want to wish everyone a happy Thanksgiving. Per usual, Wednesday night, the open house at the McKee's house. It's open to the public. Please do stop in for a beverage. Chief, any of the fellows in the neighborhood are welcome to stop in if they're working. They can stop in for a snack.
You mean if they're not working? Oh, snack.
Yes. And, that's Wednesday night, and I want to wish everyone a happy Thanksgiving and a healthy one, and enjoy the long holiday weekend. With that, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
Motion.
Ms. Frescatore, you can adjourn.